of War, I think is a pretty safe bet.
What's up, everyone? Thanks for joining us for another UFG Watches. We're going to be watching day two of IGN's Summer of Gaming. And, yeah, day one went really well. Day two, obviously, we're going to have more reveals, more gameplay trailers and such. But the big news, or the biggest thing so far, is the PS5. Sony's going to be showing that off around 4. Right now it's 2:30, so we have a little ways to go. So before that, we'll obviously be looking at games and hearing from IGN. And like before, I just want to share my thoughts. Right now it's just me. I couldn't get anybody else on at the time because they're working. You know, Corona has got everybody kind of upside down in terms of scheduling. So it's just me. However, someone might join me in the middle of the stream or in the middle of the video, and if they do, they'll let me know and I'll introduce them. That way there's not like a phantom voice that just comes out of nowhere. But yeah, in the meantime, feel free to hit the subscribe button and that notification bell so you can see when more content goes up. This right now is the they did a fundraiser just like yesterday, a speed run, I believe, with Jay Hobbs. I believe he did the first one with Doom, and this one was Titanfall 2, as you can see. But it was basically a challenge, and they were raising money for a good cause, a couple of good causes. It's the COVID-19 relief and the Bell Project, and it has the donate at the top, donate.ign.com. So definitely donate. To help out a lot of people in need right now, but yeah, we're just waiting. Got 4 minutes here. I just wanted to start before it got cracking, so it's not abrupt. In terms of the reveals, I don't want to be talking when a reveal happens and it's like but what I will say is this is assumed, because we're even though I'm watching this live, it's assumed that you've already seen it. It's going to go up later in the day, after all this is done, and it's going to be a recap, basically. And so, yeah, we assume that you've already seen it, so we're not going to necessarily worry about talking over them when they're explaining the story or the characters or anything like that. We, you sat just like I'm sitting. You saw it. And, yeah, this is to give my thoughts on top of that. So my voice is the most important one here. If that makes sense. So yeah, so waiting for her to start. We got 3 minutes. I'm gonna turn up their volume a little bit.
She's she's 14 years old.
Here.
14. I don't know. She was a rescue.
Oh, and it was also a little low. I realized it was kind of low. The recording.
From Black Lives
last
Matter,
time.
$250.
And
an outdated system and harms
again,
all
like I said, we assume you already seen it, so I didn't want it to be necessarily
Bloody
be
Mark.
That low, but
great job, team. And then we got
$100. I wanted to emphasize that. Emphasize our voice over.
So we're
at you get it.
I don't want this stream to end. It's so good.
Mark, I want to say when he went like, aw, it was perfectly timed with the Mario thing. You had like the exact same expression. It was great. It was great.
It was so good.
That's perfect. That's one of my coworkers. So I was like, guys, real quick, we are almost out of time. Brian Otto, where can we find you after we have to leave this stream?
Oh yeah, right down below. I stream speedruns, especially Titanfall stuff, pretty much every day almost. I've been doing speedrun content for a long time.
Okay, no, my fault.
If you want to see more of my
it's
stuff,
the guy talking
GDQ,
that did this
so
the speed run.
Like
the Brian Otto. There you go. He just said his name.
Again,
he was doing it. So okay. So Jay Hobbs is. Okay, he's from Games Done Quick. Okay, I can read.
No,
I can read.
If you want to speedrun Titanfall 2, go to speedrun.com/Titanfall_2. You can find the link to our Discord there. We have so many resources to get started, and like anybody can get into it. It was my first speed game. It could be your first speed game. It's really dope. It's a very good
ride. It looks really fun. Thank you for stopping by. Guys, if you like our Devs React series, Brian Otto is he's one of the people that kicked it off. I think you were like the second one with Control. So go watch that, because that video is
awesome.
That's
a good video. Yeah,
yeah, like Jay Hobbs.
Yeah, that's one of my favorite ones, no bias. Yeah.
Jay Hobbs, where can we find you?
I'm at twitch.tv/jhobbs296 or at on Twitter, j_Hobbs. Also, don't forget, everybody, that if you enjoyed all of this, we raise money multiple times throughout the year for Games Done Quick. Summer Games Done Quick is moving online this year.
I promise I can
SGDQ Online is in August. I'm definitely not stalling for time to remember the dates. It's August 16th to the 23rd. Please check that out. GamesDoneQuick.com for more information.
Mess with the sound here and there. Just
also,
to,
you can catch me here tomorrow, 12:45 p.m. Pacific.
So it's not blaring in my headset.
Be fun. Yeah, we are.
Hopefully, it's still
we'll be doing
loud enough that you can hear.
We're doing Bloodborne with Jesus,
and it's not too crazy.
So make sure to show up for that, guys. This stream has been amazing. Give me the camera. Here I am, guys. Don't forget that all summer of gaming long. I'm reading the wrong thing. I'm like out of it. I literally can't believe what we've done. All right, guys, we're mere moments away from IGN Expo Day 2. Even more exclusive trailers, new gameplay, and interviews with some incredible developers. As for our charities, we've raised a collective total of $14,673 so far from the World Health Organization and the Bail Project. The Bail Project works to restore the presumption of innocence and reunite families separated by mass incarceration. The COVID-19 Response Fund responds to COVID-19. You know,
that sounds like they're starting.
We're trying to stop it. Both very worthy causes, so keep the donations coming in, and we'll be back tomorrow with Jesus Here's Toast with Bloodborne. For extra Summer of Gaming goodness, download the TikTok app, follow IGN, and search for IGN Summer of Gaming hashtag to watch along with live events and submit your own Summer of Gaming moments, reactions, and plays. Also, don't forget to leave us a Yappa video comment on IGN.com, and it could wind up on today's episode of News, Games, and More. Guys, that's going to do it for me. Thank you all for everything you guys have done. I will see you tomorrow. But for now, get ready because IGN Expo Day 2 starts right now.
Yes, yes.
All right. We are starting up, folks. We are starting. Yeah. Again, shout out to IGN.
Welcome back to IGN's Summer of Gaming. It's a multi-day streaming extravaganza packed with brand new trailers, next-gen reveals, exclusive announcements, and never-before-seen gameplay. Oops. Exclusively here on IGN. In just moments, IGN's own Summer of Gaming Expo Day 2 kicks off, where we'll be showing off tons of brand new games and speaking with the people behind them, like Samurai Jack creator Genndy Tartakovsky, who's bringing world-premiere gameplay from Samurai Jack Battle Through Time. But we can't spoil all the surprises in this intro. Prepare yourself, because for the next few hours, you won't want to miss a beat. IGN Summer of Gaming Expo number 2 starts right now.
Awesome. Yeah! Oh, we're starting with a... Okay. Actually, I think the first day started with an exclusive as well.
Ow. I can't remember a thing.
Hey, I've got him! Wait, is this, oh snap. Is this 13?
Well, well.
Can't you see? Don't you know? You look like it might be 13. Man with a plan, and this time you understand. Get him!
You can't get away. Like I'm making look
easy, yeah. We better create a diversion.
Yeah, looks like 13. I wonder if this is gonna be
bad place to be.
Like a remaster or a sequel of sorts. I can't remember exactly what happens in the game. I haven't played it in so long.
I've fallen into my own trap. Jones, do you read me?
Use the scope. I'll cover you. Come on!
I always dug the
suspicious individuals.
Comic book aesthetics.
Who am I?
Okay, so it's a remaster. Chancellor. November 10th. He's on his way. Nice.
Hey, IGN Summer of Gaming has just begun, but you probably already knew that because we've been promoting this since April. I'm one of your hosts, Cindy Goodman, and joining me are Up at Noons, Max Scoville, and Brian Altano.
Hey, Sid. Normally in June, we would come to you live from a big studio down the street from a massive trade show to check out brand new video games for a whole week straight. But this year, we are doing things a little bit differently. And instead of just 1 week, we are bringing you multiple weeks of completely ballooned out, overstacked gaming coverage, which is good for you. And I don't know if that's great for our mental health, but we'll make do.
We'll make it work.
Not sure if we're covering all that.
We'll be carrying all the big video game announcements being dropped by all your favorite publishers.
Try to cover as much as we can.
Get all your info, IGN, and otherwise in one place, which is right here.
E3 experience, so you can,
keep up with stuff.
And besides, you're
going to
be watching
on
IGN anyway, so you'll need to cover everything. But you might want to know what we think.
To raise money for the
World Health
Organization and
the Bail
Project. Later on today, we'll have special Summer of Gaming episodes of our regular series, and potentially even more.
Our
important
input.
Sony's State of Play Showcase, which was widely expected to be the first reveal of the actual PlayStation 5, potentially even the box itself, which we haven't seen, despite talking about it, for years now.
You know, I think if they hype that up and show PS4 games, people will be pissed. Anyway, on Tuesday, June 16th, we'll be getting an intimate look at some celebrity homes and Animal Crossing Islands as these celebrities take us on virtual tours on stream to raise money in support of the COVID-19 Response Fund and to reunite families separated by mass incarceration. You can donate at donate.ign.com or by following the links in the video description. Make sure you check in all month long for nonstop gaming news. And if you're watching from your living room, you can even watch it all on channel IGN1 on your Samsung TV Plus.
Check out the full schedule at IGN.com. You can also follow IGN on the TikTok app. Search for IGN's Summer of Gaming hashtag to unlock a bunch of bonus content and to upload your very own awesome gameplay clips. Anyway, enough delightful talk from three gorgeous professional presenters. I think very highly of us.
Disagree.
Oh, that we're not gorgeous or that it's not enough talk from us?
I think it's the word professional, really. That's the one that I get hung up on that. Look at this. Look at this nonsense.
Fair enough.
Both of you are wildly unprofessional, and that's why I'm very excited to work with you. All right, it's time to get things kicked off with a bang. A fresh stack of brand new game trailers only here as part of
all
IGN
right.
Expo.
New game trailers.
Deep in the heart of the summer of gaming.
Let's see what we got.
It's going to be really fun. Roll it.
Another exclusive. Man, I wonder how 13 stands up today. Gameplay wise,
my name is Evan Capnos. My identity has been foreclosed.
You are in a stalemate, Mr. Capnos. Until the auctioning, your ID is going to be suspended.
The implants we get at birth are state property. Corporations buy the ID debt from the state.
This kind of looks like 13, also. Just. More cell shady or more
your implants are not exactly
comic
book-y
and third person and different. Yeah,
they took everything from me, but they left me with nothing to lose.
Actually, this looks kind of like that roguelite game. First person, what is it? I wouldn't be surprised if it's the same developer, actually.
If we don't work together,
I can't think of the name right now.
Lose everything.
Have a nice day, Mr. Capnos.
The one where you're in space. Foreclosed. Looks interesting. Not necessarily. Oh, wait. The Iron Claw. Okay, so it looks like a tactical game. Tactical turn base.
Ah!
retro vibes are cool. No, Iron Oath. There you go. Humble Games. Okay, I see you.
Legend tells of a place where everyone comes together to play and dance.
It's
and
a party-based game.
And shoot and jump and fly with jetpacks or maybe bat wings. And there's lava and a mountain made of junk food. You can create your own worlds and have your own adventures where you are in charge. Where you can make your very own games with your very own rules. And all your friends can come and play. Like this one here. Yep, them too. And I don't know what that dude is, but he is cool. What? They're all toys? Come to life. And I can actually play with them and own them all. It's fucking sweet.
It's a little choppy there.
This place isn't a legend at all. It's a party.
So like Disney Infinity, but like not. There's no plastic toys or anything. But it has the toy theme. Block Party. Might have to check that out, though. Seems like it would be fun, especially playing with, you know, the kids, you know, your kids or whatever, having them come up with their crazy, you know, games or, you know, worlds. I didn't see what console or platform it was coming to, though. I'll have to look back. These games are always interesting. They just have multiple elements to them, whereas whether it's RTS elements or kind of like a board game-esque, like Risk. You think of something like Risk. I'm just chopping up a little bit. Being able to plot your own course and you know, use different means of handling conflict has always been interesting to me. Like, do you use diplomacy? Do you just wage war with anyone? Stronghold Warriors, September 29th. Okay. Coming to Steam. Uh-oh. Yep, and we're back. Now this game we know already. This is the Battle Royale game that's based on Magic. So far though, it's only been in beta. Like you couldn't play, invite beta. Like you couldn't play it unless you either purchased something or got an invite, I believe. But it looked cool. The idea of using Magic to fight against people is certainly intriguing. I wonder if this means it's gonna get a spell break. That's right. If it's gonna get a release date, are we gonna get one? Nope, coming soon. But it is coming to Xbox, PS4, and Switch. That's dope. So even though we didn't get a release date.
Oh, hey, check out spellbreak.com/IGN to get a free exclusive in-game skin. Coming up later in the expo, we've got tons of never-before-seen trailers and interviews with the developers of some of the hottest upcoming titles. But right now, it's Samurai time! Samurai! Cartoon lovers should be no stranger to Samurai Jack, the time-traveling swordsman whose long-running cartoon adventures came to an end in 2017. Well, now he's back in video game form.
I still
we got a chance to talk about
Samurai
it with
Jack.
Samurai Jack creator Genndy Tartakovsky. Max, take it away. Samurai!
Like the new, the version that came back after he was, you know, after it was done. I still have to finish that. Game looks fun, though.
Samurai Jack's animated adventures came to a grand finale in 2017, but now this time-traveling samurai is back in Samurai Jack Battle Through Time, a brand new original video game. Here to tell us about it, I'm joined by Samurai Jack's creator and animation legend, Genndy Tartakovsky.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Well, thanks for making a bunch of amazing cartoons that have clearly inspired my own personal laboratory. Let's talk about Samurai Jack. This is a brand new story. It's by Derek Bachman. It takes place within the sort of Samurai Jack timeline, but like walk us
it's
through exactly
prequel,
sort of where and when, aside from through time, this is taking place.
I believe.
Well, I think it kind of picks up right where we were finishing the last season, the finale of the whole thing. And,
it isn't.
It starts, you know, we created a new mythology where it kind of starts as an alternate timeline. And Aku sends Jack through that timeline. And now, of course, Jack has to fight his way back and defeat Aku. But this time, the adventures are kind of similar, fresher, because for the first time, you actually get to control Jack and really fight all those amazing villains and henchmen and have the friends along the way that we've experienced through watching the show.
Now, this is the first Samurai Jack game in 16 years. There was the PS2 game that came out in 2004. Can you sort of talk about sort of the difference in perception of not just Samurai Jack, but kind of video games in general? It feels like it's you're under the Adult Swim mantle this time around. Which does that give you any more sort of leeway?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, you know, 16 years ago, it was
side-scrolling
video
levels.
Games
that's
were,
cool.
Especially for licensed characters, for you know, a kids' TV show, so to speak. You kind of get the B-class treatment, right? You just kind of go into whatever engine they have. They do some new graphics.
It doesn't seem like he has like a
not great
life bar or
and,
anything.
You know, it's they were doing it while I was in.
I wonder if it's
the,
just his clothing, because it looks
so
like they're being torn.
To be super involved.
Like his gi is being ripped apart as he fights. So I wonder if that's an indication of
right, even, you know,
your life,
for TV
life bar or whatever.
Or anything. And so it kind of came out and it kind of lacked what we all thought a video game could be. And then now, fast forward here. The show is more popular. The show has existed for, you know, 16 years more, and people have really gone to love it, and there's a more of respect towards it. So, my point of view from what it was to how far it's come now.
Very cool. Well, let's talk about the gameplay a little bit here. Obviously, we're going to see lots of sword swinging action because he's a samurai after all. But we also got sort of a pole arm here with some magic coming out of it. We got a shot of him in the trailer with some heavy firepower. Can you tell us about the combat a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's, you know, inspired by, you know, of course the, I think there's some stuff where he actually uses one of the bugs, one of the Ku drones' arms, and he slashes with it. There's a bow and arrow, I think. And so there's a lot of variation. There's a trident like we see here. And also taking cue from when Jack was lost in the last finale season, he also uses some guns and stuff where we never would have him use a gun in the first few seasons. But a lot of the locales.
Yeah, I think it's his clothing. I think it's gets ripped up as he takes damage.
And so it's kind of
great. Which is
because
great,
if you're a fan of
the that's
show,
like
the you
show.
Recognize the environment instantly, and you can kind of look forward to some of the villains from that environment. At the same time, we've also swapped some other villains to come in all the different various environments.
Nice. And you've also got, you've got some familiar returning characters as well, I hear.
Yes, of course. I mean, you could never do it without the Scotsman. And here, of course, is Domingo, who's one of the, you know, fan favorites, always been, has been. And what's also fantastic is we were able to use the original voice cast, right? I mean, besides Mako.
Oh,
course,
that's nice.
Who passed away. But yeah, so there's an authenticity to it.
Original voice cast is,
you know, you don't get
good
in other games based on properties.
This looks fun.
This is awesome. Now, something I'm really curious about, this is developed by Soleil, which is a studio based out of Japan. Obviously, Samurai Jack is a Western cartoon heavily influenced by Japanese media and culture, and now you've got a Japanese team developing a game based on that. Can you talk a little bit about that relationship?
It's been really good. I mean, I think for whenever you do these things, it's always great if there's a fondness and appreciation from the team that's actually going to be doing all the work. If it's just all about money and they feel like they can,
I like
take advantage
the level
of the
design
name of the property,
and how it's minimal, like
kind of,
the actual anime
the
or the cartoon.
But I know, like Derek, who wrote this,
but it still
he
feels
traveled to Japan and he met
lived
them
in.
And he
like
walked into
a,
their offices.
They have a good
and they
balance.
Had Samurai Jack posters, and they were asking about me, so they were appreciative of it. And even I remember back then when I
like in other games,
show,
it might seem to be
it actually
like
started
this is more
to air in Japan.
Could be argued that
I was really
bland.
Worried. I'm like, oh no, they found out I'm a fake.
But it's a
they'll see through.
The aesthetic matches the
no matter how much of a, whatever
the source material
appreciation that I had of Japanese culture and especially the samurai code and culture, they would still know that I'm a phony. But so I remember I was at the studio once and we had some visitors from Japan, some of these cable operators, you know, they were just businessmen. And this is years
ago.
Yeah,
the combat
and,
looks fun.
And they came into my office and I was introduced to them and Samurai Jack just started airing.
Similar to any other
and they were like
action combat game.
You did
you
a
know,
really good job. We,
but I like stuff like Devil May Cry or
sincere.
You know,
and that was the biggest compliment I could ever get.
Games of that ilk.
That it was
that
it
is,
worked
that
in
is
Japan.
So cool.
It didn't I didn't embarrass their culture or appropriate it or whatever, you know, all that kind of stuff.
I love that. So now obviously like Samurai Jack has been around for almost 20
and it seems
years,
to be a decent amount of platforming
who,
as well.
You know, maybe we're watching Samurai Jack as kids
which
are now,
that could be hit
or
miss in terms of
out, you know, making
how
video
good
games
it is.
And stuff. Have you sort of had any encounters with people working on the game who fanboy out and get completely, you know, overwhelmed by it, or is it?
It's also nice that they have 2D levels as well.
In general,
kind
of
change things up a little bit.
Like you said, it's been around for so long; it's been able to influence
and double jump.
A lot of artists.
You gotta have a double jump.
Video games and animation in general. And so when I go to conventions and all that kind of stuff, and I meet these people.
Sorry, that was my phone.
Like I was influenced by Bugs Bunny cartoons and Popeye and some Disney stuff. Take Savory, and of course, by the time I got into the industry, most of them were all gone, if not all of them. And so I was never really able to meet any of the people who inspired me to go into animation. And now it's been pretty incredible. When I go to conventions, I meet the people who say, well,
yeah, see,
I
it looks like you know,
because
and it could
Samurai
be just
Jack.
He, you know, trying to hurry up and get
you know,
through this
I
level,
love to draw because of Samurai
and so he's
Jack
having some difficulty
stuff.
Platforming,
it's,
but it could be that there's
it's beyond comprehension.
You know, it can be tricky with 3D platformers
like can,
to get
you know,
it right, get the timing
really,
and everything right.
Show them the direction in their life, which is
actually with
so,
any platformer, it can be tricky
you know,
getting
a huge
the jumping and stuff
to
feel good.
Anybody, really.
That's phenomenal. That's really cool to hear. Now, I have to ask, you mentioned it very briefly there, Popeye. Do you have any word on the Popeye movie that I heard you were working on at one point?
No comment on any of that stuff. So.
Fair enough. I had to ask, though.
No worries.
Fingers crossed. Thank you so much, Gandy. This was a huge pleasure. I am looking forward to checking out Samurai Jack Battle Through Time later this year.
Yeah, it looks good. I assume it's coming to current gen, more so than next.
Welcome back to Check Out This Game on IGN's Summer of Gaming, highlighting exciting under-the-radar games worth your time. Strategy RPG Star Renegades has without a doubt one of the coolest looking pixel art styles I've seen.
I like how they're
time.
Showcasing,
but it backs that look up with an exciting time-based combat
games that might
well.
Fall under the
Take
radar.
A look at some exclusive new gameplay.
Get over, you know, overtaken by big reveals and news of Sony's new console. It's good that they're actually showcasing that. The more indie stuff, the smaller stuff, mid-tier and all that. Star Renegades. It's actually a little too loud, so we're just gonna do one of those. So it's turn-based. Already, it looks interesting. Just from a visual standpoint. Developed by Massive Damage. That's a dope name. That's a dope name for a studio. With this, though, it's, other than being turn-based and your turns seem to change where you are on the timeline, so when your attacks actually go out, it's changed based on what you're doing. Probably have to, like, you know, channel a move or something like that, or just something that's just a little slower.
Like what you see, then head on over to IGN.com or YouTube.
But not too much
IGN
about the gameplay is being shown.
Extended version of this gameplay.
But like I said, you can watch it, the extended version, elsewhere on IGN. So they'll probably, if they don't come back to it during
that
the show, they'll probably
Tom
talk about
Mark
it there.
Some inside info on Star Renegades. If you like Tom, I have great news because he will be right back to tell us all about Iron Oath along with one of the game's developers. But first, a little tiny break. Stay tuned.
IGN Summer of Gaming is brought to you by Fuser, who'll be partying with us all summer long.
So while this commercial break, we could talk a little bit about what's been shown. Samurai Jack has always been interesting. I thought it was interesting when I saw it, when they announced it a little while back. Because it's Samurai Jack. I mean, who doesn't want to play Samurai Jack? And just kind of delve into that. I did think it was a prequel. The way they kind of announced it, it was more, this takes place before the end part, or the final season, and after the Cartoon Network stuff, or the, you know, that's those seasons. But it seems like it's an alternate timeline. I'm not sure how that works. We'll have to wait and see if they kind of explain that a little bit more. But the show always dealt with time, so it could be something where it's kind of both. Like, you end up in the past, and then you kind of go to the future, or, you know, vice versa. Like, something happens where things kind of, you're kind of out of whack. Like, there was a moment in time where he wasn't where he should be, and he kind of gets back to that before they go towards the end of the season, of the final season. So, still be canon, but kind of meshed in between two different eras of his time, which would be interesting. But the gameplay-wise, it looked like it would be fun. Nothing too crazy in terms of, you know, new mechanics or different action gameplay. Like it doesn't seem like it's gonna revolutionize anything. And that's not necessarily the point. The point is just to make a decent Samurai Jack game. And I think it looks like they've managed to do that. It didn't look bad.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to IGN's Summer of Gaming. My name is Tom Marks, and I'm joined today by Chris Wingard and Nick Mueller, who's a little bit static today, of Curious Panda Games. How are you guys doing?
Great.
Doing very good.
Curious Panda. So
we're
going to look at Iron Oath.
We're going to talk about your game, The Iron Oath. So just to set it up, tell me a bit about the game. What is The Iron Oath?
I think, like, at its core, the game is about taking a mercenary company and just, like, living the life of a mercenary, like, owning your own mercenary guild and managing all of that. That's sort of, like, the main thing that you'll be doing.
So you're a group of mercenaries.
And that's turn-based combat. As we're seeing here, pull up, tactics-based, kind of hex-based gameplay, right? It's a turn-based tactics game at its core as well.
Right. So you're managing your guild, and then you take them on missions, and then the combat plays out on a hex grid.
And one of the things I wanted to touch on too is you guys started out on Kickstarter, I believe.
How long? 2017.
2017. So that you've gone on long, like 3 years now. How has kind of that journey been?
It's been longer than we wanted it to, but you know we've made a lot of improvements to the game. And you know we've come a long way.
This is a Kickstarter game,
That it's in and where it's going, and
kickstarted game.
Really excited for people to get their hands on it, hopefully soon.
Well, since we're seeing it right now,
the characters
now,
look kind of cool,
combat,
especially the bad guys. Is he holding a body?
You know, there's a lot of different flavors of turn-based tactics and hex-based stuff and all that sort of goodness. What kind of sets the Iron Oath apart? What did you want out of the combat? What's important to you?
I hope it's not a roguelike. Not that I have any problem with roguelikes, but we have so many.
You want to tackle that, Chris? Or
yeah, you can jump in.
Yeah, so we really wanted, like, firstly, like, our hero design. We really wanted them to be pretty diverse and not... I guess a bit different than like your stereotypical classes that you'd normally encounter in an RPG, like a guy who's just a tank and, you know, a typical mage who has ranged abilities sitting in the back. So we kind of, that's our main focus, just like having powerful characters who are unique. And then just like the Pyrolancer, for example, that guy with the black armor and the lance, he's a melee fire mage. So he's an example of that.
And a melee fire mage. That sounds cool.
Sorry.
I was just saying, yeah, initially he was just a guy that stood in the back throwing fireballs, and we decided, like, you know, that'd be kind of boring if we just completely took the tropes of every RPG and instead decided to give, like, a little bit of a twist on all of them. So instead of just standing back and throwing fireballs, he gets up and close and deals fire damage like that.
And that was one thing, like, I was noticing watching this gameplay as well, is it seems like positioning is really, really important here. We already saw it a little bit earlier, but... One character placed a little fire sigil, and then another character knocked them into that, which then knocked that person farther away.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there's a lot of synergies between abilities. Like the Pyrolancer places down that hex, and then there's a lot of abilities that can
push
or
pull.
And so you gotta try to plan ahead and take that into account.
Trying to plan where you put your units on the grid. And trying to figure out
a lot of environmental,
like,
hazards too,
you know, where you should be if, like, when the next person makes their turn, if you're in a bad spot, you're gonna have to move before then.
Plan out where you're gonna go,
kind of plan, like you said, plan where you gotta go, and how your attacks will affect the other characters and how they move them across the board or around the board or grid.
Dungeons and Dragons, there's like attack of opportunities, so if you get close to someone and then move away, they're going to get like a free.
I wonder if there's
you.
Any like
so you can't just move
synergy in a sense where
really, like, think about what you're going to do with
I don't know like elemental in the sense that you know
from the movement
you douse someone with oil and then you know your fire mage set them on fire.
I feel like attack of opportunities is something that I would think I've seen more.
That's something
of
we've
that
seen in
games, but it feels like this is one of the
gameplay
first I've
footage of Baldur's Gate 3.
Lean into that idea.
Yeah, we really wanted to
and a few other games
also have ways around it.
Recently,
like, it's not gonna like,
that was a thing
that we thought we might run into is just characters would funnel to a point, and then they would just trade blows and then it's done. So, but to counteract that, we have a lot of characters with mobility. So instead of just running into a place, like the Valkyrie is a class that she can fly several hexes across. So if she needs to get out of somewhere, she can use that to make a whole lot of distance, and then we have other abilities that, you know, can knock back, and then that allows you to walk away.
And I say that they needed they were making a diverse cast in terms of
in a later part
I would assume character design, but then also character type, and they kind of mentioned that a little bit. with the fire mage that's melee as opposed to someone who stands back casting fireballs, he actually, you know, is fighting, like, you know, fist fighting, not fist fighting, but, you know, with a weapon. So that's interesting, but I wonder if these are characters that you kind of make up, like you customize your character, then you want him to be this role, this role, or if it's something where, like, you meet this character who happens to fulfill this role on the team, and you recruit them, since they're a band of mercenaries. That kind of makes sense.
Person looks like they're in trouble, and you could choose to help them or not help them. So that's where, like, a lot of the events will come about, is from these just dynamic encounters that come about as you're exploring the world or dungeons. Like, you might run across other events mid dungeon that are unrelated to the quest you're currently tackling.
Yeah, there's a lot of, like, text-based encounters. That's part of the inspiration is from D&D in that aspect. It's just, you know, little choose your own adventure type things while you're on a mission. It's not necessarily part of that mission, but it's just something you can,
I like,
choose to do
the way it looks. I wish there was a little bit more in terms of
and that's also what I feel like what a lot of,
I guess, fighting the environment, like fighting in interesting environments where,
essentially,
because right now it's grid based in the sense that you can knock someone here or there,
right, yeah.
And
yeah, I was also a big fan,
use your,
like,
abilities
Berserk,
to attack,
like,
them
the Band of the Hawk, the
based on their positioning, but it would also be interesting if, like, you knock someone into a pool of something, or you know, you have to worry about someone having a height advantage if they're an archer.
You mentioned Valkyrie, which is now we're actually,
like, that would be kind of cool as well. Not as saying that the game has to have that, but
characters specifically are
playing other games that are similar.
That kind of get assigned a class. Are they?
It seems a little bit more on the bland side.
That sort of aspect of it work.
Again, this game is still being developed,
so
you know, there's that as well.
You recruit them, and they age. They retire or they die in combat, and then you'll eventually have to replace them by recruiting new people. So the classes themselves, there's 8 classes that we'll be launching with, and
okay, 8 classes. That's good. That's good.
The person is dynamically generated whenever you need to.
Okay,
someone.
So yep, he just said it. They're dynamically generated.
Recruit
the
them,
characters.
You train them up. They have
so
traits, they have,
they'll have their own, you know, you'll get a class, this particular class, but the character itself will be different each time.
Have, like, their abilities, and you can level
so that's cool.
Abilities with different skills to try and augment them.
The characters can also be customized a little bit too. You can tweak the colors. Also, the portraits in the top left, those can all be changed, so you can, like, give people different hair or hair colors or different, you know.
Yeah,
because,
like,
if,
and what I mean by, you know, going
now,
back to the environment, Divinity, the Divinity series, the original Sin, one and two, for Larian Studios,
sort of,
like, they have a lot of environmental
are,
stuff where, like, you go to fight and it's, you don't get sucked,
you know,
to a place or whatever. You're actually fighting within the environment that's there. So there's a tree in the way or, you know, a barrel of something explosive. You have to kind of contend with that when you're fighting.
Like, when you're traveling,
you know, don't
world,
stand there, you know, because
an
archer might blow you up,
take time for
type of thing.
Heal,
or,
like,
you know,
be injured. Like, right now on the top left, you'll see there's little icons.
You don't want to get yourself
got, like,
boxed in into a corner because there's a wall or something. Like, those things you have
to
kind of take into account. And then also you can flip it. You know, if someone is standing in water, you use a lightning ability and it, you know, takes them out because they're in water. So, like, that's something that I would kind
of
want to see. But aside from that,
base building management
looks interesting. I would like to hear,
like, how much is that actual management side of things,
a little bit about the story, if there is a story, how in depth it is.
That's right, you jump
right, seeing as how these characters are kind of
so
randomized
manage,
a little bit,
you know, the recruitment obviously first and foremost, and that was just a violent death right there that just occurred, and it so
that was like a fatality.
So you manage the recruitment aspect, and then you manage like their, when you're recruiting someone, you have to manage the contracts. So the contracts kind of work like sports contracts, basically. So you sign someone, and they'll be with you for 5 years at a certain amount of gold per year. And then once that's up, you got to renegotiate a new contract. And then aside from that, you also have to kind of manage each individual's happiness a little bit. So if you're not using them, or you're not using them in the way they want to be used, or you're making choices that they don't necessarily agree with, they're going to have problems with that, and they might end up leaving your company. So you have to manage that aspect, and then as well with the whole overworld, there's a bunch of different factions. So you have to kind of manage your relationship with all these different factions, choose who you want to ally yourself with, and be wary of who you make enemies with, because they might send bounty hunters after you or and stuff like that. So there's a decent amount of management to go on, but there is no base that you have for your company, but there is a skill tree that you can work towards getting different upgrades.
I gotta tell you, Football Manager, but for D&D nerds, is something that appeals to me on a deep, deep level. So I'm very much looking forward to this. Thank you to both of you for sitting down with us, talking about it, and showing it off.
Yeah, thank you very much for having us. We appreciate it.
So yeah, that was Iron Oath.
For even more Summer of Gaming goodness, download the TikTok app, follow IGN, and search IGN Summer of Gaming hashtag to find a slew of bonus gameplay clips and upload your very own epic gaming moments.
I certainly do love the epic gamer
moments.
I'm
not getting TikTok.
We just took a look at Star Renegades and Iron Oath, and now it's time for a chat about foreclosed. And although it might sound like a depressing game about real estate and mortgages and your landlord, it's actually a colorful cyberpunk adventure. Here's your first look at some gameplay.
Foreclosed is a gorgeous new cyberpunk game with a beautiful graphic novel aesthetic. Here to tell me about it are Andrea and Lara from Antab Studios. Welcome.
Oh, awesome, because I want to hear more about this game.
Hey, thank you. Hi, everyone.
So Foreclosed is set in obviously a beautiful cyberpunk dystopian future. Can you tell me a little bit about what this universe is like, who the main character is, and what is being foreclosed exactly?
Okay, yeah. So the main character is Evan Kapnos. You can see him into the gameplay video. And he's the everyday man in this dystopic future. And to tell about this story, we have to explain a bit about the context. So in this future, everyone has brain implants. And brain implants are used to be connected with cities, so to have any kind of interaction. The key concept
like my
is that
sketches
the
in Photoshop
identity
to life
of a
before they're finished
is basically just a bunch of data, and it represents a node into a gigantic blockchain, and it's embedded into your brain implants. So it's something that is given to you by the state as soon as you are born, as a way to interact with the universe. The absolute story of our character takes place because when you are old enough in this universe, companies can buy what we call the identity debt of the citizens. It means that since the implants you get from the state, they have a cost. That cost represents your debt to have an identity in this environment and to interact, to have any kind of transaction with the city to buy stuff and so on. So companies buy this debt from the state, and you actually work for the companies basically to pay your debt. And the absurd thing that happens to Evan is that in a mysterious way, the company you work for goes bankrupt, and you have to understand why. But the main thing is that your identity gets foreclosed just like any other goods.
Wow, his identity got foreclosed. That's crazy.
And
and like at the very beginning, you just reach the court and do some paperwork just to try to find an escape from this bureaucratic mess, we may say.
I wanna, since it's an alpha, that's why they're not, those guys are like blank looking.
Mysterious agents start to chase you.
Or is that something in his mind?
So now you have to find a way to escape from the city before the opening, but
some Black Mirror stuff, man.
Yeah, yeah. Then there's a quick escalation of things that happens to the main character. As soon as you think the story is about fixing the paperwork, basically, what happens is that you are involved in something bigger than you, and the key story is that you have to understand what's going on. You have to try to survive and to get out of the bureaucratic mess.
So it sounds like some good dystopian noir, appropriately cyberpunk. Can you give us a sense of how the world is structured? We've seen some sort of, looks like some good exploration and going to different areas, but sort of how are players engaged with this world?
Okay, so we wanted to give the idea a little of
again, this is pre-alpha, so playing, I'm just saying what I'm looking at here.
And we worked really hard to give.
I like the mind hacking.
So the game is not an open world game.
Whatever he was just doing.
And it's mainly story driven, but we blend everything seamlessly together. So you will not have a feeling of different levels. Or you know, level one or level two, and so on. The storyline builds up as you move into this world, and you will not see loading times or something like that. So it's
like
just
he has
a fluid,
a form of telekinesis,
experience.
But it's
this is
it's cyber based or cyberpunk
based. The feeling that you are playing it's a fully playable cyberpunk comic book.
Yeah.
So
a cyberpunk
this is
comic.
The key thing. Yeah.
Let's talk about the combat a little bit. It looks like we're using some implants to throw dumpsters at people. Yeah, explain that, please.
Yeah, so as you're seeing, like, implants are extremely important in Foreclosed. They are like your curse and your blessing. And that's because you have an experimental firmware installed inside your implants, and this firmware is going to give you, like, incredible combat skills and powers. You may see inside the video you have like telekinetic kind of abilities, so you can lift object, throw the object through the enemy,
hacking machines.
You can lift your enemy and like freeze them in the air. You can slam them down. You can do this kind of stuff. You also have a very special weapon, which is built to connect and work with your implants. And this is a symbiotic.
So all upgrades are based on implants.
So, you can actually equip different kinds of bullets, and this allows you to turn your weapon in what you want. So let's say you can transform a simple gun into a machine gun, or into an explosive kind of weapon. And you can also combine different kinds of bullets together.
Yeah.
One thing that you have to take care about is that because your powers and your implants are experimental, the system is a bit unstable. So when you use your powers, you're going to overheat your implant, and you have to take extremely care of the heating.
Oh, wow. So you can overheat your implants.
If you overheat the implant,
since they're experimental.
It's a very painful kind of overheat, and you have to wait until the system cool down completely before being able to use your powers again.
So you can't use your powers. So that's that acts as the cool down with them overheating and possibly stunning yourself.
Be careful because of the overheat system.
Looks like that's the same with the guns as well. Like
powers are unlockable in a RPG style, so.
That could be fun and not at the same time, especially if you have to do a lot of
it's going
shooting.
To upgrade itself as
yeah, like he switched to a
you,
more lethal gun or gun implant, but it looks like he's overheating, so he has to like hide
till
it goes down some.
Is, most suitable for you.
And then obviously you can use other abilities, but I want to say they also cool down or need a cool down.
Throw stuff in the air. You can use telekinesis to attract
so that could be an interesting
shields,
to challenge to get around.
You can, lift
and just also like really annoying, depending on how
keep, energetic shields,
they balance the challenge and the amount of engagements versus the cooling
you basically make your,
mechanisms.
Your own strategy for fighting.
Oh yeah, and like you're also seeing that in the video. You can also hack devices and systems all around, and depending on the device you're hacking, you will perform different actions, you may say. So for example, opening a door or making a cabinet explode, and you can even act brain implants of an unaware enemy.
Yeah, so we can use some stealth elements in some fight. It's not something that is always there, because we have stealth when it makes sense for the storyline, but it's also an ability you have as a player.
Yeah.
Well, you've both been clearly hard at work along with the rest of the team. What platforms are you looking at, and what kind of release date are we expecting?
For release date, we can just say it's going to be Q2 next year. So 2021.
So next year, yeah.
And platform, we aim to, we are working on PC, on Xbox, Switch, PlayStation. So
all the platforms.
Yep. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for showing off Foreclosed. It looks great.
It has some interesting things going on. And it's alpha, so we're definitely going to have to, you know, check it out a little bit later and see how they, because there's some things where I couldn't tell what was needed to be worked on and what was just the way the world looks.
Brian, to donate to worthy causes by following the links in the description of this video or by heading to donate.ign.com. You can give to the COVID-19 Response Fund dedicated to
definitely donate
tracking and combating COVID-19.
If you can,
or to the
obviously.
Bail Project, working to reunite families separated by the mass incarceration system.
And for even more Summer of Gaming goodness, download the TikTok app, follow IGN, and search for IGN Summer of Gaming hashtag for bonus gameplay clips and to upload your own awesome gaming moments. Next up, Blanco's Block Party looks like a cross between Little Big Planet and collecting Funko Pops, but first, a quick break. We'll be right back.
Okay, so Block Party is next. Cool, so we can kind of look at that and see what's going on there. It looks like it could be fun. And that's just based on the charming aesthetics and the kind of create your own, you know, way of playing sandbox type gameplay. That's, you know, something that's seen in, like I said, Disney Infinite. Or sorry, Disney Infinity. Except for you're not collecting figures, and these guys aren't known entities. They're people that you create, or characters that you create using various parts. Hopefully they show the customization, how that works in the game, and how you can make your own characters. I wonder if something where you collect pieces, kind of like a Little Big Planet, or if it's all there from the beginning, you just kind of have to, you know, how you create them is based on how you manipulate the pieces that are already there. Which, if it's like Disney Infinity, you know, that's something that would be really cool, seeing as how Disney Infinity is no more. I mean, you could still play it, but, you know, there's not going to be any sequels, there's not going to be any, they're not going to update it anymore, it's just what it is. But it was definitely a fun sandbox game, especially, I mean, the playsets were cool, but I think my kids enjoy the sandboxy stuff, because they can kind of do whatever they want. You know, I mentioned, or just trying to explain what it was to friends. I talked about how I was playing as Thor, and I was manning a gun or guns on the Millennium Falcon, while my daughter flew around as Stitch. And that's just, I mean, that's just kind of like what it is, right? Like it's all these different Disney properties smashed together, like toys, and you can pretend to do whatever. Like you would with your toys.
And that's why I love you.
So if this is more of the same,
oh, hey, Sydney.
But
back.
You know, newer. I would definitely like to check that out.
I mean, obviously, they made like 4 movies about it, so it has to be true, right?
What about high-end designer vinyl?
That said, I would also like to see how they
myself and my friend the giraffe
differentiate themselves from
you know,
that game.
They probably come to life too, since there's going to be a video game about it, and video games are pretty realistic.
They certainly are, and so is my giraffe. I can't fault that logic anyway. The game's called Blanco's Block Party, and if I'm not mistaken, we've
Blanco's
time
Block
with
Party.
Back and forth.
That's what it's called, not just Block Party.
An exclusive interview with one of the developers, so let's check it out.
Sweet, let's see it.
Let's see it.
Party over here, party over there.
Blanco's Block Party is a game about a bunch of little vinyl figurines that come to life and get into all sorts of trouble. Here to tell me about it is Jamie Jackson, the Chief Creative Officer for Mythical Games. Jamie, how's it going?
Hey man, what's up, Max?
So it's the Voxel characters. I can see that he collects
them. Tell
me
about this game. Tell me what's going on here.
Oh, man. So Blanco's, like you said, the vinyl toys come to life.
Blanco, like Funko. Hi, I see. I see what you did there.
Whole kind of this is where the kind of idea of is where Blancos go, where vinyl toys go when humans aren't in the room. So the place that they've created is their block parties. And then there's a kind of big place we call the Junction, where they can go and hang out and train up and hang out with their friends. But the stuff that you're seeing now, this is actually all in the UGC side of it. So you can kind of build and create your own worlds too.
So that's a huge part of the whole like vinyl doll.
So you can create their own world.
Sort of existing figurines.
But there is a world
stuff.
You can explore as
can
well.
Can you talk a bit about how in-depth the user-created content side of this is?
Yeah, sure. So from a Blanco side, we're actually working with a bunch of really cool vinyl artists to come and have their artwork in-game on Blanco's, much like in the real world. But from the UGC side, this level, everything we're looking at now is all levels that we've been built in our editor. And the point of the editor really was to build it with a controller. We wanted to make it really easy for players to build worlds, whether it's just a hangout, somewhere they can go and hang out with their friends.
I wanted to see what was at the top of that.
Or they can actually drop gameplay
speaker
really easily.
Mountain or whatever.
To code or open any boxes to type in code. It's everything can be done with a game controller. You just have to drop a toy in, really easy parameters to set. Season one, we're going to be dropping things like this, shooting and racing, vibe collecting, kind of platform style gameplay. The key part is it's really easy to build levels.
Cool. So you're talking about controllers. What platforms are you guys looking at?
So we're going to be launching on PC later this year, and we're going to be announcing our console strategy in a couple of weeks, hopefully.
Of console to follow.
Now this is going to be a free-to-play game, is that right?
Yeah, that's right. It's going to be free-to-play.
Ah,
so
free-to-play.
There's
going to
be a ton
all
of content for players just to come in, play, build, even kind of train up a Blanco to a point. But then if you want all the cool Blancos and that kind of stuff, that's where you're going to be using the in-game currency to buy those.
In-game currency to
now,
buy extra
people.
I can
tell
people.
By the shelf behind you, you are a fan of
but what,
vinyl and
what
and
can you
toys.
Buy, though?
Can you talk a little bit about
for
some of the artists
tangible money.
So far?
That's
so
what I want to know.
Getting into the artists yet, but if you know anything about this world and any of those artists that are in there, we've definitely got an amazing lineup coming. And you know, we live in a world of seasonal content now, so we're gonna just keep getting better and better.
Nice. Now, so in terms of sort of how you know, how you said you're gonna have racing and shooting and obviously plenty of platforming. What are you using to determine sort of what direction you want to go with things in terms of sort of
Sorry, I missed that last bit.
Oh, sorry. Like, what are you going to be sort of following the community's lead in terms of this, or do you guys have like a pretty strict plan in terms of what you want to roll out first and what kind of content you want to let people play around with?
Yeah, I mean, we have a really good idea of what we want to launch, but the main thing for us is to listen to the community as well. So we want to really kind of build for them, because the idea of Blancos is you kind of build what you want to play. That's the kind of approach we're taking with the UGC side. So although we have a ton of plans about what we want to bring, as we get through seasons, we start to see what players do and how they do it differently. We definitely want to listen to them. I think.
So I wonder, do you invite someone to your room or to your world and then you build it out?
Players always play the games.
How does that work if it's
a different way than we expected them to?
Free to play.
And we want to take that on board and just try and provide a bunch of really easy tools for them to do exactly that. And then watch what they do and listen to what they want and then drop that in them in future seasons.
Cool. Now, Mythical is a fairly new studio, is that right? But you've got a bunch of people who have like really a lot of experience and some pedigree. Can you speak a little bit to that?
Yeah. So we're almost coming up to 2 years old. It was founded by myself, John Linden, and Rudy Koch. John and I were both studio heads at Activision, so my background was DJ Hero and Guitar Hero. John and Rudy both worked a lot on Call of Duty Skylanders franchises. So, you know, even from the just
he's hanging from the balloon, like creates.
We've just added to that,
the world.
Bringing in people from the mobile world as well. So, having that great free to play expertise, World of Warcraft. So, the games everyone's worked on have been pretty incredible.
What kind of lessons did you learn from sort of working in the, AAA space that you're bringing to the table here and really sort of turning players loose with?
I mean, that's a great question. I think some of the biggest ones was don't assume you know everything the player's going to do at the beginning. You know, allow a little bit of room for them to make the game their own. I think, you know, you see that in a lot of products these days as players find new ways to play. The developer's able to kind of switch around and kind of really enhance some of those options for them. So I think that's probably one of the big things. And, you know, we've really kind of spent a lot of the first part of this project prototyping, playing with it,
pretty,
and thinking about
pretty snappy.
You know, how do we want to
putting these games, different pieces together
and not being a programmer or a coder or anything like that. So making sure it's really, really easy to get into, I think, has been the biggest one for me.
We're seeing a lot of level design here. Will the Blancos themselves be customizable? Will people be able to sort of do their own character creation?
There is going to be some things you can do to Blancos. As you play through the game and you play both like in the single player and also in the multiplayer and the kind of UGC modes, you're going to unlock different attachments. So you're going to be able to put different backpacks and jetpacks and various attachments on a Blanco. Some of them will just be cosmetic and just look really cool, but some of them are going to enhance the abilities that a Blanco has. And you can train your Blanco's abilities as you go through a game. So when you get a Blanco at the beginning, it will kind of start at zero, and you can train it to be
okay,
good.
So you can level up,
things.
You can train.
You can make it really cool at the shooting. You can make it really fast and responsive for the platforming or racing. And we're going to announce some stuff a little bit closer to launch about some of the other things you can do to customize them.
That looks cool.
Now, obviously, free-to-play does make some gamers raise their eyebrows, but we've seen a lot of really sort of successful models lately that manage to, you know, balance making a profit with also offering a good user experience.
Yes, let's talk about the profit aspect
of things. Can you talk a little bit about how you're approaching monetization here?
Monetization, yes.
Yeah, I mean, like you say, I think there's some great examples out there now, and we're in a different world than we were 5 or 10 years ago. You know, our key thing is that anyone coming in just has a really good time straight at the beginning and has feels value even in that free-to-play piece. You know, we're going to talk a little bit later on about our structure, but, you know, you're going to be able to buy Blancos. I think there's some great games out there that are, you know, we all think in seasons now rather than Blancos 1, 2, and 3. So definitely expect us to kind of take that same approach and be dropping some great content in a seasonal approach.
Now, you mentioned some of the team, you know, has a background in Skylanders. The sort of Toys to Life craze hasn't really had the best history recently. Are there any plans to make physical Blancos, or is this strictly going to be a sort of virtual collectible?
Well, you know, Mythical's kind of thesis really is, you know, owning digital content is the future for us. So the thing about Blancos is with each Blanco, you actually own these things, right? So they're yours to do with what you want. And that's about the digital ownership. Who knows whether we bring them into real world later on? I mean,
yeah,
they're designed around
trying to be
toys, so
have these
be
as physical things would be cool,
but right now, Blancos
rather
is all
difficult,
about
I would imagine.
And
unless they have Blancos
the
that are like this is a specific version
awesome.
Or a specific
and,
Blanco.
What are you expecting to sort of launch
versus what someone
or,
has
more
designed
about
or made?
We're aiming to launch end of the year, so towards the holiday period.
End of the year launch. All right.
We're actually going to be having our kind of beta phase sometime towards the end of the year as well. And then we're going to be letting you know about our platform strategy pretty soon.
Thanks so much for coming by. I look forward to checking out more about Blancos.
Looks like it could be fun.
In the near future.
I'm not sure how I feel about it being free to play, outside of the fact that you can kind of just jump in and try it. And how they're actually going to. They didn't talk about too much about how they're going to monetize things. And if it's something where it's like, you know, he talked about seasons, if they're going to be seasons, is it going to be like a battle pass type of thing? Or certain cosmetics are locked to a season and you kind of have to kind of opt in or buy into it so you can get, you can unlock, maybe you have to play these challenges to unlock cosmetics and, you know, I'm kind of curious about what that would be. Bravery Network Online. Oh, this is a fighting game? No, it's turn-based. I'm digging the music. So it's kind of like Pokemon, like they're tacking in different fighters with different styles to kind of fight against each other. like something that's a little bit more, this fighter might be, can counter this particular character and vice versa. Yeah, that's what it looks like. Beyond that though, I have no idea what I'm looking at. The character designs are kind of interesting.
Like, if you see, then head on over to IGN.com or YouTube.com/IGN to watch the full extended version of this gameplay.
I kind of want to know more about it though. But yeah, this is not... Like, it's cool to see gameplay, and then it's like, some of those, some of it's kind of like, it leaves much to be desired, I guess you could say.
Hi, Seth.
Thanks for having me. Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, thank you. So, let's just start off. I mean, like I was saying, coming to Xbox and Switch. Can you talk more about that?
Yeah, it's super exciting. We're really, we've been working on this for a while, and we have been, you know, hoping to deliver this. A lot of people in the community have been asking, you know, when are we
going, I'm curious. Although, I don't know if we need any more,
Can't wait to play it on my
excuse me, any more Battle Royale games?
Definitely really excited to be able to bring,
I mean, this one certainly looks, you know,
so we're looking
different.
Forward to it when we get to full release later this year.
Full release later this year,
right.
Okay.
And so it's already on PS4 and PC. Are there
PS4, PC,
yep.
Yeah, so we currently, the beta itself that is on PS4 and PC right now has cross matchmaking, and we definitely are looking for...
Gonna have cross play, that's smart.
...continue to allow for cross play when we get to full release, and we're excited about really letting players, players that are anywhere, play with their friends. It's one of the things that we have kind of built the idea behind Spellbreak around, is the ability for people to be able to play with their friends whenever they want, and so we're excited to be able to do cross play at launch.
Yeah, no, I
don't
use
any fall damage with him jumping like
that.
Excuse me.
So anytime the game supports crossplay, I am all for it. So
yeah, talk.
That said, I feel like a lot of different games handle crossplay different ways. I'm not sure how far you guys are in kind of knowing.
It's nice
how
that
you're
Sony's
to do crossplay,
doing that,
but is it something
allowing
that
crossplay
you can
now
out of and only
with,
matchmake against other PS4
Xbox
players or,
I mean,
other.
That's not novel,
players,
I guess,
like,
anymore, but
how will crossplay
at the same time, it is.
Yeah, so definitely, you will be able to opt out if you don't want to, and be able to play with just whoever else is on your designated platform. So if you're on the PS4, you can decide.
Aside from crossplay, I would like to have cross save.
That will be available. And
like, if I want to jump to
said,
PC because I like the PC version
now,
a little bit better,
is basically allowing for cross teams, so you can.
Then I would like
your,
to keep my unlocks or you know purchases
squad,
and stuff.
Or some of our other game modes,
like Fortnite does with,
mm-hmm.
you know.
And for everybody
thing.
Who, this is your first time seeing Spellbreak, do not worry. We are going to get to talking about the nitty gritty, but I just find crossplay is so exciting. So a few more questions about that. Let's say that I have Spellbreak on
There you
PC,
go. She's asking
but
it.
But now I'm also going to have it on my Switch. Are you able to have the same profile on both? Like have your achievements and whatever carry over?
Yeah, so that's like getting to true cross progression, which is sort of one account everywhere. And that's something we're definitely looking into. And I think we would love to have.
Okay, so
that.
They don't
that's
have
kind
that.
Of the dream, right?
Not
is
yet.
As a
but
player,
it's promising that they're looking into that.
Any platform of your choosing, as long as
because who wouldn't
so
want to, like, you're playing on your PC and then you're like, hey, I'm going to go out of town or something.
Awesome.
I'm not bringing my PC with me. I'm going to bring
my
Switch.
And I basically was just given the definition. But that's okay.
So I want my
so
progression.
Let's just jump into Spellbreak for people who
that
don't
makes sense.
Know what
so I'm glad
is.
That they're looking
give
into
us,
that.
Like, a quick synopsis.
Yeah, so it's an action spellcasting PvP game. The primary game mode that we're launching with is Battle Royale. So you'll be able to team up with three players.
What is with this three player thing?
Person lobbies. And so
maybe
that's
just a perfect number or something.
All the gameplay is, I think,
like,
the core
in terms
combat,
of
which
an
is,
entire lobby.
Of course,
because goodness,
you play as a battle mage, as well as a lot of the like movement abilities. I think the key things that really define Spellbreak are the combat and the kind of sort of like verticality and movement you see in the match. So players are able to do everything from blink to levitate, and you actually equip two magical gauntlets, and that's what you use for all of your attacks. So it's sort of a blend of what would be like an ability shooter and a more, I think, like MMO style combat where you know things are on cooldown and you want to be tactical on when you're using your abilities at the right time. So that's kind of what defines Spellbreak.
Yeah, MMO styled.
Yeah, or because you obviously know, there's cooldown a lot based of battle royale games on the market.
Battle royale is interesting.
A really good job kind of carving its niche, because I definitely haven't played any battle royales like it. But with that said, what similarities, maybe for folks who are huge battle royale fans, can they expect in Spellbreak?
Oh, do you start so, with I mean, all yeah, the gauntlets?
Of the mode itself.
I haven't played it yet, so
you know, you want to be the last either squad or individual standing, and you have a set of safe zones that get smaller over time that pull everyone together. You drop in with no loot, and you need to loot as you go. And so those are all the core tenets you'd expect.
Okay, so there's loot and all that good stuff.
We do try to find ways to make it really fit for the style of game that Spellbreak is, though, because like one of the big differences is while we do have something like the safe zones, like the new areas outside, the circle areas that are iconic in Battle Royale, we also mm-hmm. make it so that every time you get to one of those circles, you actually level up your class. So you pick a class in Spellbreak, and each circle you hit, you get stronger and more powerful. And so it's a little bit more like a MOBA in that way than it is, I think, like a standard sort of Battle Royale mode.
Yeah, no, I love that mechanic. MOBA I think elements. It's such okay. an interesting thing. To add to the battle royale genre. With that said, so I'm gonna squeeze in like one really quick question because we're almost out of time, but I know that we have a really special announcement at the end of this and I don't wanna cut into that too much. But I think that the community around Spellbreak is so robust and I know you guys rolled out a new patch about a month ago and the reaction was super positive, but how do you balance community feedback with kind of you and your team's original vision? Because there seems to be a really good line of communication there.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of the things that we focused on as a studio. We've had players in playing Spellbreak in some form since the summer of 2018. And the way we kind of look at it is there's three components that we care about. It's really getting the player feedback where we want to go and the actual direction that that we see from the stats in the game. And we balance all of those together to make our design decisions. And that's why player feedback has been so critical and the community has been really helpful for us to make the game what it is today.
Mm-hmm. I'm happy to hear that. I always appreciate like positive relationships between a game and their community. Obviously, I'm not advocating for negative relationships there. Anyways, so you and your team have a really special
They have a surprise.
Everybody
okay.
who wants to play
okay.
Spellbreak and all the Spellbreak fans that are watching this stream right now. So why don't you tell them what we got?
Yeah, so we have an exclusive outfit available for those of you that are watching. There's a limited number of them available, but being a new game and a relatively small team, we look to our community to really help us out. And so we thought this would be kind of a cool way, a cool little reward for folks that are helping us in the early phases. As we're
I
still
like his wall mounting there.
Close to launch. So the outfit is called Treeline. And so it'll be available for folks that are watching now to go pick up. So we're really excited to be able to offer that to the community.
Yeah. And thank you so much for bringing that to our viewers. So before we go, I know you said an official release date, maybe you had like a time frame?
Later on this year, sometime Perfect. In 2020.
Thank you so much, Seth.
Sometime
in
2020.
More about Spellbreak in the future.
I would like to play. Eager to see if there's any synergy between spells outside of, you know, what we saw, like the kind of like a rocket jump. Shoot the fireball down.
Go to spellbreak.com/IGN to get your free exclusive in-game skin right now. Well, we're almost out of trailers for now, but we still got two more IGN Expos coming during the summer of gaming, and each will be filled to the brim with premieres and trailers, like some kind of overflowing frozen tropical drink with exotic fruits, twisty straws, crazy silly limes, and lemons, and squiggles, and sandwiches, and great, great stuff.
Delicious. Not only that, but more charity streams, Sony's Future of Gaming event immediately following this, and our Animal Crossing New Horizons Celebrity Island tours on June 16th. For a complete schedule of Summer of Gaming events, and believe me, there is a whole lot more, so make sure you check out IGN.com.
So but Sony's, we aren't done yet. You know, it's hard to think of anything more grossly irresponsible than letting an infant operate a motor vehicle, and yet, here's a game that does exactly that. I hope someone got fired for this one. Let's check it out.
Rated E for everyone.
Nickelodeon, huh? So another kart racer.
Boys and girls, to the slime event of the year. Select your crew.
Kart racers is back.
Start your engine. Cause it's race day.
Hey Arnold!
Battle your way through all new slime-filled tracks. Watch out, Leo! With even more of your favorite characters than ever before. Hey there, JoJo! Now race with friends. Compete online. Now that's what I call racing. Nickelodeon Kart Racers 2 Grand Prix.
That's cool.
Coming soon.
All the Nickelodeon fans out there. Me included.
IGN Summer of Gaming.
Although it's hard to top.
Will be partying with us.
I mean, they have some. There's some solid racers out there. You know, Mario Kart obviously being one. Mod Nation Racers was really good. Anybody own the PS3? Mod Nation was great. Shout out to UFG. Not us, but the other UFG. Unfortunately, they're not around anymore. Definitely a good kart racer. And the Sonic one. The Sonic racer. I forget the name escapes me, but that one's also really good too. Pretty solid racers out there, so. It's cool to have the Nickelodeon characters, though. So far, so good. We had a couple of some cool video games being shown, a lot of which probably wouldn't be featured in a broader showcase like the normal cons. They'll be seen, you know, like behind the scenes, or you know, like Nintendo's Treehouse. They'll be brought up then. So it's cool that they're out front and in the limelight for a little bit. Because we know the bigger titles are going to soak up a lot of the news later, so definitely good on IGN on that. And so far what we've seen has been interesting. From Samurai Jack to Blinko Block Party to 13's back. Foreclosure had an interesting... Everything was interesting about that game. The combat, I would like to kind of get my hands on or kind of see more to see how the cooldown, you know, with the implants or mods, how that really works. Because that could, you know, that could make or break the game in that sense. And the story seemed interesting. It was a little, I don't want to say complicated, but there was a lot going on. And you know, the idea that your personality can be foreclosed, I mean, that's different, right? Oh, looks like we're froze up a little bit. All right, well, let's just give him a sec. Gives me more time anyways. But yeah, the visually it looked cool. Though it's still an alpha, you know, still an alpha right now, so it'll probably look even better when it gets closer to launch. But that's definitely a game to kind of look out for. Did they just wonder what's going on? What's going on, IGN? Boop.
5 will bring to the table.
Ah, there we go.
Does the PS5 have what it takes to dominate next gen? We're about to find out when Sony raises the curtain on the future of gaming.
11 minutes.
Sit back and get ready. IGN Summer of Gaming is here.
I'm more concerned about the price of the PS5. Is any exclusives? But mainly
Welcome
the price.
Welcome back to IGN Summer Definitely of Gaming. I am Max Scoville.
And I'm Brian Altano. And for the next few weeks, we'll be bringing you all the biggest announcements, trailers, reveals, and gameplay, plus tons of exclusive content that you won't find anywhere else. But the biggest event of the year, maybe even the decade, maybe even the century, might just be happening very, very soon in just a few minutes. Right, Max?
That's right, Brian. As many of you in the chat know, we are just moments away from Sony's big future of gaming event. I'm sorry to keep you waiting. If we could watch it just ahead of time, just push play and make it happen early, we would, but we can't do that. So we are just spinning our wheels and twiddling our thumbs and hoping that we get an idea of what PlayStation 5 has in store for next gen. But that's only the beginning.
That's right. The PlayStation Vita 2 press conference starts in just... No, I'm kidding. The PS5 event starts in just a few minutes.
Bro.
And we'll be chasing that with a post-show featuring the cast of IGN's PlayStation show, Beyond. Hey, that's us. Followed by IGN's Next Gen Console Watch. Hey, that's other people. And then news, games, and more. Hey, that's sometimes some of us. And
so, yeah.
That's the way we'll close that
so
our
we'll
day.
Be closing
so just
it
nonstop coverage for the next
few
hours.
On the Sony stuff.
Then, tomorrow, it doesn't stop. We'll have the third IGN Expo, our presentation of world premieres, developer
and
interviews,
we'll,
and brand new gameplay.
I believe we'll
and
be
I know
doing
we hype up
a video
stuff for
day three.
IGN, but I gotta say, this is like a truly
I'm not
incredible
sure just yet.
Stuff planned for the next few weeks. Just a nonstop bonanza.
There's
of
a lot of news coming
of
out.
Video
like,
game
all
madness,
over the place.
And I am so damn excited.
Yeah, I am looking
this feels
forward
like we're real
to the
E3
Guerrilla
right
Collective.
Like
we're doing our best. It's a weird
sponsored
long E3
in part by
spread out over the course of a month.
Kind of funny games.
We're
gonna be looking
anyway,
at a lot of indie
games. In
addition
to the hottest, biggest, loudest, noisiest video game reveals, IGN is also sending donations from
showcased
the
on
Health
Twitch,
Organization and the Bail
as
Project.
Well as
I'm sure
I believe
you've heard about
GameSpot
this
and IGN
because we have been drawing attention to it. That's called a call to action, and it does call people to action. You can find donation links in the video description or by heading to donate.ign.com. And charity is great on its own. It's a nice thing. It makes you feel good about yourself. But by donating, you can also enter for a chance to win awesome prizes, including a custom Summer of Gaming Xbox One X if you chip in more than $50. We have currently raised about $15,000 as of...
Actually, it's just over $17,000 now.
Okay,
we're at $17,171. So keep that going, keep pushing that. Remember this is not only for a bunch of great causes, but you get a chance of winning a very, very limited edition console, that is going to be hunted down by collectors decades from now.
That's awesome.
They will
pay
you handsomely for that. Because they're weird.
Anyway, enough about a limited edition Xbox. Let's talk about everything we know about the PlayStation 5 so far.
The PlayStation 5 is set to be released this holiday season, and we've finally been promised a look at PS5 games to come.
Are we going
to
get a launch date, though?
Games at this reveal event
are we
going to
get a price point, though?
We do know about the PS5.
I'm pretty sure we're
going to
get at least one of those.
Price details, or even a first real look at the actual console.
It'll
so,
be nice
to
see
to
up to
speed for
some
reveal,
games, too.
Here's everything we know so far about the PS5.
As much as I'm not ready for the next
Sony
gen, I am looking forward to it.
Yet,
it's just exciting.
Mark Cerny told Wired last year that the price would be, quote, appealing to gamers in light of its advanced feature set, unquote. For reference, the PS4 costs $399 at launch. Similarly, we still don't have a firm release date.
$399 would probably be the best price point.
To a holiday 2020 launch window.
$600, like the
PS3 in November.
It's probably not be a smart idea, especially with coronavirus and all that.
Media, playing 100GB Blu-ray discs and supporting 4K Blu-ray playback. Cerny primarily focused on the PS5's unique solid-state drive, one he claimed, quote, has a raw bandwidth higher than any SSD available for PCs, end quote. Cerny compared the load times of Marvel's Spider-Man on PS4 Pro.
Load times, that seems
to
be to the
that on a PS5 dev kit,
what everyone's looking at right now.
Seconds. The SSD is
graphics,
also meant
yeah,
to allow
but
the PS5
mostly
to
load times this time around.
Ever,
same thing with the Xbox Series X.
To rethink how they
Xbox One.
Games and maybe
no.
Someday,
Xbox Series X.
Regardless of having to ride a loading
that's what it's called.
Or squeeze through a narrow pathway to cover a load screen ever again. The PS5 will let players install games in segments, allegedly support 8K gaming, even though that probably won't be as big a deal as they're making it seem, at least for a while.
Yeah, I don't believe 8K.
Saving capabilities
we're barely at
4K. Suspended.
No like word yet, like though, actual 4K gaming, 60 frames per second, like 8K, yeah.
Another major push by Sony will be 3D audio, built into the PS5 on a system level, which will allow players to have a more accurate indication of where unseen enemies are or where their gunfire is coming from. Plenty of third parties have already announced games in development for the PlayStation 5. Among the biggest are Ubisoft's Assassin's Creed Valhalla and Gearbox's Godfall, a three-player looter slasher that will be console exclusive.
Again, three.
We've
also heard
Bluepoint Games is working on a PS5 game as well. And while Sony itself hasn't revealed any first-party games for the PS5 just yet, we did get a look at what third-party games could look like thanks to the first Unreal Engine 5 tech demo.
Yeah, Unreal always looks great. Heck, Unreal Engine 4 maxed when they showed that.
The majority of the PS4's 4,000 plus
tech demo was amazing.
And for those who
still
bought into PSVR this generation, fear not. Sony says the PS5 will be backward compatible with current PSVR hardware, which is great considering big titles like Marvel's Iron Man VR are still coming. Still no word, though, on when we might get a PSVR 2. Unlike Microsoft with the Xbox Series X and Xbox One, however, Sony is seemingly not interested in making sure games developed for PS5 also work on PS4. Quote, we believe that when you go to all the trouble of creating a next-gen console,
PS5 games will not be backwards compatible.
And benefits that the previous generation does not include.
I think that's more. That's more. I don't think Xbox is against that or balking at that though, because I think eventually there's going to be games that are just developed for the Xbox Series X. That's just how it goes. They're more focused on if you bought Xbox One games now, them playing on the Xbox Series X.
The controller will also include
and buying one, you know, version and getting the second version. Like, that's what they're concerned with. But I don't think that, I think it's the same as Sony. Like, yeah, you're going to be able to play your PS4 games on the PS5. But if it's something that's specifically only can work on the PS5, they're not concerned about PS4. And this, I'm pretty sure it'll be the same with Xbox. Right now, that's not going to be the case because the Xbox One and PS4 are still viable consoles. So, heck, they have a freaking Last of Us 2 special edition coming out. Like, it's obviously they're not gonna leave it in the dust completely. So, yeah, it's the same thing.
We are just moments away from Sony's big, huge PlayStation 5 Future of Gaming reveal, but we need to take a very quick break. Don't forget to download the TikTok app, follow IGN, and search IGN Summer of Gaming hashtag for extra content.
That said, it would
be
great if you could use your PS4, PS4
right
controller. Play your PS4 games like Xbox is doing. That will be great. And you don't have to
IGN Summer of Gaming
necessarily. You don't have to do that. That's always been an issue with, you know, from Nintendo to Super Nintendo, right? Like, that's, you get the new system for the new games. It's just good not to have to, because everything is digital now or is going digital. It'll be good to have that come with you now. Like, before, it was expected because you know you're getting carts or whatever, cartridges, and so the Nintendo ones aren't gonna fit into the Super Nintendo, you know, slot or whatever. Like, it's different tech. But being digital is like, and then the fact that we have things like the Game Pass, Xbox Game Pass, yeah, it makes sense to be able to still play those games. You know, because they're trying to be like Netflix in that sense, right? You pay a subscription, you get all this stuff. You know, you think of Netflix, it's not going to be different because you're watching on your phone versus your PC. It's going to be the same. I mean, the quality will be different. PC could have better, you know, visually be better, you know, 4K video. Maybe not so much on your phone, but you can still watch whatever it is. And so that will be the same in terms of games, right? You have the Game Pass. I could play Cyberpunk. I mean, that's not going to be on the Game Pass, but let's say it was, right? Or scratch that. Halo. Halo's going to be on the Game Pass. So the new Halo game, I'll be able to play it on Xbox One and Xbox Series X. That just makes sense. But vice versa, I can understand, like, if Halo was just going to be an Xbox Series X game, yeah, you can't play on Xbox One, so you have to upgrade. But at the very least, the way Microsoft is doing it, you can keep the controllers. You know, keep your stuff. Keep your headsets. you know, your peripherals can go with it. And that's really cool. So you don't have to upgrade everything. So, like, yeah, I like what Microsoft is doing, which is why I'm kind of leaning there. I want Sony, and again, I need these consoles to kind of do my job. So, like, I'm going to get both eventually. But which one I get first comes down to personal preference. And so I'm looking for Sony to kind of show me something that make me go, yes, Sony. We can argue exclusives, yes or no, but
welcome back, everybody. Yeah. I'm joined by the cast of IGN's I'm regular PlayStation for... Show podcast Beyond, Lucy O'Brien, Jonathan Dornbush, and my pricing. Good buddy Brian Altano. We thought we'd have way more
those
time
features,
to talk
like
about
I said, the backwards compatible features.
Any minute now, rapid fire, really quickly.
And the games that I like to play.
What are we expecting to see, Jonathan? Go.
As much as I like Uncharted, I also like.
I think we're definitely
Gears
going to see
for,
something
for
from Insomniac. They're the most recent first party studio. I hope it's Ratchet. I don't know if we'll see Spider-Man 2 just yet, but I think we could see
so,
definitely something.
As they're talking, yeah, I want to see the gameplay. I want to see the loading
see
that they're
it,
talking about,
see
like Microsoft
I
did. I want to see
remake of
the price point, the release
Ryan,
date,
guy,
how
what
the PlayStation 5 even looks
I
like,
gameplay, I want details, I find out about
and I want some exclusives that aren't just one player. I mean, granted, Sony had some exclusives that were multiplayer, but you know, like Killzone. But a lot of it was, you know, Uncharted. I mean, Uncharted has a multiplayer mode, but for the most part, you buy it for the single player experience. So
Souls.
Uncharted, Spider-Man,
that would be a weird curveball to
God of War,
there.
Like, those are the games that I bought specifically for the PS4 because they were exclusives and I wanted to play them. But a lot of my multiplayer stuff I bought on my Xbox One. And Xbox One had, you know, like the Forza and the Gears and the, you know, Halo and stuff like that. So multiplayer, single player. You know, obviously they go back and forth. Not everything is multiplayer on Xbox, and not everything is single player on Sony. But yeah, that's something I'm looking forward to. Make me want to get the PSN Plus or whatever. And then there's also.
This is the first event
something that combats the gameplay, the Game Pass, because that's freaking awesome, right? What else I would like to see?
I got like the pre-E3 jitters, basically couldn't sleep well last night. I was just like, I woke up
too excited
for this. Well, it's funny that before changed with E3, Sony wasn't going to be there, and now they are the ones hosting the biggest conference the week of what would have been.
I think that's it. You know, exclusives.
Yeah, this actually would have been the final day of
you know,
really
entertaining. Or, you know, things that I think would be really cool, entertaining. Yeah. Also, maybe an upgrade to PSN. Like, PSN isn't bad. It's definitely better than it was on the PS3. But I still like how Xbox does things. For instance, being able to find people to play with. You know, find a player or find a group or whatever. Like, that functionality is really, really cool. Stuff like that.
Will the console be a part of that, or will that just
is why I kind
of
lean
like
towards Xbox Live and whatnot.
It'd be really
but
weird if the whole thing had like a subwoofer.
It would be interesting to see if Sony implements some
I,
of those
I,
things.
Like,
they have some
I
cool features too, like the remote play
with, like,
that they had with PS4
sensor,
was pretty
now?
Cool. So I'm looking
it's
forward.
It's starting. All right, well stick around. We're gonna do
to hearing as much as I can, essentially.
PlayStation 5. Let's do this.
PlayStation.
Hey.
Here we go.
I think there should be, yeah.
Let's do it. Let's turn up a little bit. Crap, now I'm probably going to be behind because I pressed pause. Oh well. The Sony fanboys are losing their minds right now. And I don't blame them. Sony's been winning for a while now. That's a cross, everyone. It's not an X, it's a cross, apparently. Sony.
Choices.
Oh, they're going the nostalgia route. No. Okay, I see you.
I like the hand we've been dealt.
Dude, a new Twisted Metal would be awesome. Heck, I still need to finish some of the games on my PS4. Still games we're waiting on. PS4. Ghost of Tsushima. There's another one. PS4 is still viable.
Why did I move here? I guess it was the weather.
Rockstar?
Or the... I don't know. That thing. That magic.
I thought we was trying to get out of
this. Wow, are you
shit.
Kidding me? GTA 5 again. Like a snee eye. Yeah, it's every day. Dope game, but you like really?
My job, my score.
How is GTA on every gen? Sheesh.
We should talk about work.
We out here gang banging like it's 91.
We all love banks.
I mean, it makes sense. Their online mode is you know, people still play.
Give me a hand with these bodies.
This cannot be traced back to me.
Champagne, anyone?
Just sort of smash things.
Now what?
Expanded and enhanced. Coming 2021. Wait, what? Huh, well then. Just gonna give them cash like that? Okay. I mean, that certainly incentivizes them sticking with Sony. At least when it comes to GTA, so makes sense.
It was great to kick today off with a look back at just some of the seminal moments of the last 25 years. And what better way to bridge our past and our future than with a game that's graced every PlayStation console, Grand Theft Auto. It's been a privilege partnering with Rockstar Games for many years now, and we're thrilled to open today with the news that that partnership will continue with PlayStation 5. It's now just over a year since we began sharing technical details of PlayStation 5, but today's the day that we've been looking forward to for years, when we get to show you just some of the games that demonstrate our belief that PlayStation 5 marks the biggest generational transition our industry has yet seen. The content we've curated for today's event
at least
showcases
until PS6
how
PS5 comes out, right?
has inspired developers to create new experiences that are transformative in how they look, sound, and feel. Enough from me. We're going to have the games do our talking.
All right, let's see what we got. Captured from PS5 systems. Okay, if you say so, Sony, because you know y'all be with the mirrors, smoke and mirrors. Same thing with Microsoft and basically, actually no, Nintendo doesn't do that too often. Now that I think about
a
it.
A hero is just someone who doesn't give up. Your dad said that.
Is this a new Infamous?
He was right.
No, Spider-Man!
Now it's your turn. Go be a hero, Miles.
Okay.
Let's do this.
Yep, you had to know that was coming. Miles. All right, give me a sec. We actually have Andre gonna join us real quick.
ということで、すごく興奮しています。今回のグランツーリスモは、おそらくこれまでのグランツーリスモのファンの方がプレイしたら本当に嬉しいんじゃないかなっていう、キャンペーンモードを中心にしたグランツーリスモになってると思います。ぜひ楽しみにしていてください。
Yo, what's up, man? I can't hear you. Mic is low. There we go. There we go. Everyone, this is Andre Thomas. He's the editor at United Front Gaming, and he's going to join us for the Sony. I told you someone was going to join us. I know you're amped about seeing Miles. Is this Gran Turismo? Gran Turismo always looks amazing. Even though I prefer Forza over it, visually, it's one of the best looking games. It's always one of the best looking games ever.
Hey, all this race stuff, cool, but did you just see Miles, bro? I'm losing my mind.
Miles was
losing my mind. Oh my god.
We knew it was coming.
I know, but it just, oh my god, seeing him in the suit, and then you got to see the venom sting. Oh my god. And then you see the camo where he went invisible. Oh my god. Kenny, you know he's my favorite Spider-Man. I'm losing it. Look, Kenny, he came up on the screen, right? I got out my chair, I ran up and grabbed Zudy. I said, I know you don't play video games, I need you to understand this, and I need somebody to yell at. Miles is in Spider-Man. I just ran back, dog. Like, I just needed somebody to yell at, man.
As soon as I saw your text, I was like, yep, that's what's up. I'm looking forward to it.
To this day, Adrian's still playing Spider-Man, but he saw Miles, and he just beat the mission where, like, Miles is, spoiler alert, Miles' daddy scene. And so Adrian came upstairs and was just like, Daddy. I said, what happened? He said, Miles dead. I said, oh, you really playing the story? I thought you was just swinging around, man. I'm so sorry you had to experience that. I'm so sorry. I am so sorry, Adrian. Like, I felt so bad. He was hurt, man. He said, Miles is sad, Daddy. I said, yeah, he is, man. Yeah, he is.
Yeah, man. I still gotta finish Spider-Man myself. I was telling everybody, you know, it's one, there's too many games, because honestly, like, when we're reviewing something will come out that we're not reviewing, and so we have to spend all of our time playing that, you know what I mean? But then I was saying how the PlayStation 4 is still viable because there's still games coming out. Like, The Last of Us comes out in, what, a week or so or 2 weeks? Yep. Like, it's coming out soon, or next, I think it's next Friday.
And I think most of that was due to that leak, man. That got pushed up.
It did, but it was still coming to the PS4. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so it's like, as much as I'm not ready for the PS5, I'm still excited, though. I'm still excited to see what they bring.
Kenny, you know my old saying, when it comes to old-ish. So,
right, you need the new hotness.
I'm getting that new ish, dog. I gotta get that new hotness, dog. You know it, man. Like, I'm just trying to figure out which one I'm buying first.
Yo, new Ratchet & Clank. That's just what's up.
Right. See, they get me. I need this first party stuff is what I'm talking about. I have it in my sight. They have found us, Ratchet. Oh, this looks ill.
How much steer this thing? Ask nicely.
You always win with Ratchet and Clank. Like, it's such a good series.
Mm-hmm. It's essentially like when they show up with like Mario games for Nintendo, it's like, you know, I'm gonna buy it.
Yeah. The dimensions are weakening. Solid games.
And this looks fantastic too, by the way.
And this is all being pulled from the PS5.
Right. This is what I'm talking about. Like when Microsoft today little think about the game is gonna change. I'm like, bro, don't do that. Like, wait until like you're about to do this.
Exactly.
About how the game is about to change. Don't do that because you got people who are looking for like game changer stuff, and it's a whole bunch of like non-exclusives. Like, this is the sort of stuff I want. I'm about to go watch that Miles trailer again. I swear to God, losing it. I knew he was coming, man. I absolutely knew. I played the game all the way to the end of the DLC. I knew he was gonna be in it. But dog, like Miles has been on a win streak. Co-op?
Maybe they've had co-op in Ratchet. In this before.
We are too late. Ratchet?
Who?
Oh, snap.
Okay.
Isn't his whole thing that he can't find anybody else that looks like him?
Hi, I'm Marcus Smith, creative director. That's kinda of Insomniac dope. Games. The entire studio is so excited to be able
but
to share with
different.
You a first
universe
ever look at Ratchet and Clank Rift Apart.
Wait, Insomniac, didn't this Insomniac do Spider-Man?
Built from the ground
yep.
up for the PlayStation.
So they're doing two titles
doing
right now.
We've never been able to
they also did
like, use dimensional rifts to be able to
I'm trying to think of the other joints they did because they got Insomniac got some hitters on PlayStation.
Yeah.
But they coming out with like, yo,
all
they say no wonder they back to back
with
like
density
this.
And
yeah,
life
but they got gameplay.
Well, see, Sony bought them, so it's like I knew they were gonna, you know, yeah, right after after Spider-Man was successful, yeah, they bought them.
Successful to the point that like I got friends who legit bought PlayStations for Spider-Man, dog. Like
for now, here's another look.
Well deserved.
They're gonna do it again. They're gonna do it again. Oh, okay. Gameplay.
Yeah.
That's dope.
You see him like pulling portals?
Yeah.
Oh, we get combat. See, this is what I'm talking about. This is what I need. This is the sort of stuff I need. You selling me right now, Sony. Yo.
It just looks fun.
This looks so ill, dog. Like, look at him just dropping through stuff through those portals. And who didn't love Portal?
I know, I know, right?
Give me any excuse to play something similar. Oh, I see you, bro. Like, stop playing and give me a Jack and Daxter. That's what I need. Stop playing. I need a new Jack game.
Well, Night Dog's been super, you know, Last of Us.
I
will never get used to focused on that.
Well, I mean, that's a console seller too. So.
True. I can definitely see them making a new Jack after. Shoot, they might want to do it because it'll be less, you know, graphically intensive and whatnot. Like, it'll.
Well, you know.
Not to say it's easier.
I'm not going to play Last of Us. I acknowledge how great it is, and I ain't playing that.
Yeah, I know why you aren't.
Nah, dog. Listen, I own The Last of Us, bro. Got the remaster. I got through the first part where, like, you have to, like, crawl through a grocery store, essentially, and it's just, like, those little jump, the ones that hiss or whatever, but ain't got no face.
Right.
Mm-mm. Nope. Done. Nope. My anxiety don't need this. I'm gonna go play something else.
For everybody, you know, like Andre does not do survival horror at all.
Nope. None. None. Not at all. I acknowledge the stories, but like I can watch people play it, but I can't. And the only reason I can watch people play it because I can just get up and walk off. Like if I do that with the game, dog, it's never gonna get beaten. So it's
my I was surprised you were able to beat Metro.
Dog. So before I played it, I didn't know what it was. So I went into that blind. So yeah, I kind of did that intentionally because I'm trying to break myself out of that stuff. But dog, when I got further in that game, I was like, why did I do this? So stressful, dog. Once the like the undead looking stuff because they've been hit with this radiation started to pop out on you. Mm-mm. It's a good game though. It is a good game. I ain't going back though. I did my job.
I read your review, yeah.
You see me? I said I did what I needed to do, but I'm never playing this again. Okay, this is what I need right here. This is the sort of stuff I want to play. Right here, dog. Right here. I don't know what this is, but I'm buying it.
Alright, so this looks like from
Project Athia. It don't even have a name yet, but look at this dog.
I think I'm a little bit behind you.
You are.
Oh, it looks pretty dope, though. Is she controlling vines?
Bro. Dog. Exclusively PlayStation. Come on, dog. Like, God. Come on, dog. Like, bro, I swear, Mike's out gonna have to come over here and, like, really wind and dine me right now, man. I need them to really wind and dine me. Don't come to me with no, like, do you want to get the large size? I need 3 course meal, bro. Don't play me right now, Microsoft. Game Pass is life, but I would get it on my computer.
Yep. Alright, I see you, Sony.
Right, bro. Like, Sony is out here like, yo, we won last gen. We coming out again swinging. But that's why they focusing on the games. I love that they did this. Just focusing on the games. This is played on our console. Focus on this. Like, they don't give you all the razzle dazzle. Guess what else we can do? Like, nope. Here's some games. And they all look different. Every one of them look different from each other. I don't even know what the hell we're looking at right now. It is a robot essentially at a barbershop, bro.
Yeah, I'm getting there. I see him in the alley.
That thing is weird, man. But I'm interested. I'm intrigued. Like, what is this madness? Wait, are we the cat?
Maybe.
Dog, this game gonna sell 1 million off cat lovers alone. Look at it climbing up the building like Ezio, dog.
Hello, not there yet.
Yo. I really think we the cat. Stray, we the cat. Look, I know that it's super different. I'm not even a cat lover, but it's small stuff, man. That game don't look like nothing else I've seen yet, man. Like,
Stray. Okay.
See what I'm saying? Like,
it's interesting. Like, it's really some interesting stuff.
I'm interested, right? Because it's so different. Like, that's the thing that I like about, they talking about hardware. 4K, Ultra HD Blu-ray. Ultra high speed SSD. Okay. Ray tracing.
Oh, wow, I'm behind. Maybe I can refresh. Bro. Well, I don't want to. I'm recording it, so I don't want to, like. Because then they'll miss it.
Mm-hmm. What particular stream are you watching then, though?
I'm watching on IGN's. Because I was covering IGN's day 2, and this is part of their day 2.
Yeah, no doubt. Yeah. I was on it at first and hopped over to GameSpot.
Got you. Yeah, I like how they collaborated with all this to kind of give us an E3, because we don't have it
yet, and they're all kind of working together. I bang with that.
The controller does look dope, looking at it again.
Bro, it looks like it. What it look like?
It looks like a kind of like an old Xbox controller.
Exactly. Like,
I still need the analogs, though. I want the analogs to be separated from my shooters. I can't stand the analogs together.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. It's so good for fighting games, though.
Yeah, their D-pad is great. Like,
yeah,
I just need controller. I need them to collaborate, fam. Like, I need you guys to make the ultimate
making
controller.
Games used to be about these concent trade-offs between the artistic vision and technical limitations. With PS5, we're not going to be burdened like that. We're going to be able to realize our artistic vision a lot better. It's got a ton of horsepower, which is very easy to unlock. And it's a machine that's really easy to develop on. The PS5 will present a paradigm shift as to what players will come to expect from gaming. Mm-hmm. Will let us tell stories, make worlds, create gameplay that I think will truly captivate the player.
See, you know what I bang with Sony? They're not doing this world exclusive. Like, they're not doing that. World reveal. Like, they're not playing us on that. Like, not masking the stuff.
Yeah, because right now, at least from what I've seen, they're not showing anything that. They say exclusive, but it's not really exclusive. They used to do that a lot.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, no,
Microsoft
it's really
still do
not.
It to this day. Like, they live on it, man. It's annoying to me.
Over and over.
Okay. All right, we got some new ish. I'd like to preface that by the time you get to this video, you should already know I'm not playing this ish.
Oh, word. Let me see.
There's some stuff you like, oh, like you look at it, like, it looks interesting. I'm like, nope. Nope. It is one woman walking by herself on some planet. Nope. Already done. Mm-mm. She ain't the Spartan. I ain't doing it.
Nah, she's a. I see her crashing. Man.
But it's totally different again. Yeah, like, see, I knew you was gonna say that craziness. This world is becoming part of me. Look at, oh, wait till you get to the gameplay part. Never mind. Okay, hold on. Never mind. Never mind. This joint kinda tough. Yo, okay.
So it's like a third-person shooter.
It is. Returnal?
So I think, so the survival horror stuff is probably just in the cutscenes.
Yeah, I can deal with that. My only hope is to break the cycle. Alright, I ain't seen any game yet besides that one that I'm just personally not gonna play, but it looks interesting. That I didn't actually get. So.
And shout out to them for making whoever this developer is for making a having a female protagonist and being single player. Like that's
finally.
You know, that's two swings, you know, in the opposite direction of what now people
think.
Now
I have to make a female protagonist for once.
Yeah. I mean, I know we're getting that in The Last of Us 2 and we had a couple
she
others.
She is brutal. Wait, what is this?
Yes. Hold up, I haven't seen it yet.
Yes.
I haven't seen it.
Yes. Sold.
What is this?
So excited. Wait till you see what it is. Pumped. After we lost them as a group.
What?
United Front Games, man. The boys is back.
Wait, are they?
I don't know
they?
About them.
No. It's Sumo. Oh, Sumo. Them. Sumo Digital took over.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, United is still gone, unfortunately. This looks dope, though. Yeah, you know how I am with platformers.
I love these games. I will buy anything with Sackboy in it. Oh, and this looks fire.
This is great.
Wait, four players?
Yeah, that's an easy purchase. Yep. That's an easy purchase.
Day one. I love anything Little Big Planet.
I hope it's a launch title.
Then they made it a platformer. Like, it was already kind of a platformer, but it's just kind of straightforward here. Because it's not called Little Big Planet.
Right. It's his adventure. I wonder if there's exclusive levels for four players. Because it seems like it changes based on how many players you have.
Yeah. Well. What's that guy?
Yeah, I am. Yep.
They hitting hard right now, Kenny. They coming out with haymakers. Kenny, I don't know what this is, but this next part look fire. I see black women.
Oh, dang it, they didn't give us
a
date.
Black dude? I don't know. Destruction All-Star? Wait, it's Cars. Uh-oh. Roller Derby.
Oh, this is the Ubisoft title, I believe.
And people out of their cars? You can fight outside of it? Yeah. See? Diversity.
Oh, wait. This isn't the Ubisoft. This is something different.
This is some... Out of this... Kidding. I'm... Look. I ain't been here that long, Kidding. But I'm buying a PlayStation 5. I'm telling you that right now.
Destruction Derby.
Ew. Look at this. Look at this.
You know, on the you weren't here, but like I was saying, like a new Twisted Metal would be dope.
Yeah.
And this isn't Twisted Metal, but it looks cool.
This it ain't gotta be. This looks super cool. It's like a squad-based racer. This is gonna be ill.
Yeah, Demolition Derby, like, squad-based.
Yo, she just cut through a... Dog. Destruction All-Stars. It's okay. You got my money, Sonny. Just keep... My wallet is already in your hands, and you just... Now I'm gonna have to give you my child soon. I don't have that.
You ODing right now.
Bro, they ODing, man. They could have came out a little softer than this.
Nah. They was like, we ain't get to do our E3 press conference. We're you know, coming out swinging.
Hold on.
I mean, this is kind of beneficial to them because, you know, they can sit back and kind of organize how they want to do this. It's probably saved them a ton of money, too.
Look at the next game, dog. Look at the developers, man.
Hello, everyone. My name is Josh Greer. And this is
nice.
We're from Ember Lab, a small team with a background in film and animation.
And we're very excited
I'm
to
buying
share
it.
With you the first look.
Yeah,
like, I haven't even seen it yet.
It's a story of adventure and charm.
They are brothers, like literal brothers, but also brothers.
So please enjoy.
Fire.
Yes.
Whoa.
This is visually awesome.
Whoa. Whoa. I was already gonna buy it, man.
Ember Lab. We gotta remember them.
If this ain't on Xbox, I'm sorry. Xbox is, Microsoft gotta come out here and show me two brothers that are brothers with a game. I'm sorry, man.
Oh, we got another female protagonist.
Am I biased? Maybe. Am I stoked?
Man, yeah. Based on what's going on right now, I'm biased. Whatever.
Yeah, I'm buying it. I'm rooting for everybody black, man.
Facts.
Look at this. This game looks way bigger than I thought.
So this is like action adventure.
Yeah, but look at this. The statue controls. This looks cool.
Have no power here. Kena.
Yo. Yep. Okay, Sony. Yo, this looks sweet.
Man,
she grew.
I'm in Jamie's spot. Yesterday we were recording day one, and I was ahead of him, and I was saying, "Oh, this is amazing." He was like, "Man, you're killing me because I can't see it." So now I'm in his shoes.
Wait till you get to the kingdom.
It's like she's fighting like stick or
wait till they get to the end of it.
Tree dudes.
Finisher. It's amazing.
It's a Kena Bridge of Spirits.
Yeah. Did you see that ending with the grass?
Yeah, that was cool. Alright, Sony, I need a price. I need a price, fam.
You see what I'm saying, though? Like, they out here. Like, not only did they come out here with some diversity in the games, but the characters are different. All the stuff looks, like, none of the games look exactly the same. Visually, everything looked dope, but they're giving me gameplay. Like, they're not playing with the, like, cinematic stuff, which
you
I think
right.
is so like great. Like, dog. And then you give me, like, diversity in developers. Like, y'all didn't just put a bunch of white dudes up here. Killing it, Sony. You are killing it. And Microsoft did all that investing in a small.
Sometimes I feel
yeah.
standing on the.
But so, but remember, Sony did that last joint. They did. They didn't have as many, obviously, because Microsoft benefits from having PC. But
I'm looking forward to it. Like especially if Microsoft is watching. Like they got to prove something. So I'm for it. Like.
Let me tell you something, though, Kenny. I don't want just like Halo 12 and stuff.
Yeah, oh, facts.
These are, besides Spider-Man and Gran Turismo, we're constantly getting new IPs. I need new IPs. That's what blows me about Microsoft. Like, we got a bunch of sequels, so I would like something new. We had Sunset Overdrive, and they got no support after, like, a few months. Think about how popular
and that game was good.
Yeah, and they just didn't support it. Another, what is it? Bleeding Edge? Dying. They just don't do enough support. They don't add enough stuff to it.
Well, that's not necessarily Microsoft. That's the studio. Because that's
I'm talking all the like main games, like the stuff that's exclusive to them. It just don't get the support long term that it need for it to even survive nowhere. Like to this day, Spider-Man is still like Spider-Man was getting suits months after that game had been over. Like plenty of people had beaten it. Done all the stories.
Well, I mean,
stuff.
They
still getting stuff on it.
They have been doing that with like games like Sea of Thieves. Game that I've been dying to make. Because that's way better than it was before.
Story, yeah, that needed to, though. That's another one of the games. It's hilarious, and the memories should last you a lifetime.
Take a look. All right.
That game is super fun when you got people.
Let's see what we got
here. The fact that this is on this, please don't tell me it's a PlayStation exclusive. If this is PlayStation exclusive, this is a kick in the nuts to Microsoft, because this is what I bought on my Xbox, my OG Xbox.
Another Oddworld game?
Listen, I'm saying if it's exclusive to PlayStation, Kenny, that's a huge punch. Because remember, we all had that on Xbox.
You may have escaped. Shoot, it came on PlayStation first.
That's crazy. The fate of your entire people. It looks amazing.
Is this a remake? Oh wow, this looks awesome.
Right.
Oddworld Soulstorm.
How would I feel, Tokyo?
You know what? They didn't say exclusive. Some of these I realize aren't saying exclusive. PlayStation 5 Tango GameWorks. They make good games. Ghostwire Tokyo gameplay. All right then. Supernatural de mysterious na Tokyo. Soko ni somu
kyoi to utsukushisa wo kanjitotte itadakeru to omoimasu. Zehi. Oh, no, never mind, not playing it.
Yeah, I knew you weren't going to play it. But yeah, some of these aren't exclusives. I'm noticing.
Oh, yeah, they only seem to drop the PlayStation joint in front of them.
Yeah. So, you might get, you know, because it's one of those things where like it's being shown off, but it's not necessarily their own game.
Yeah.
So that might, you know, that helps Microsoft definitely. Your threats, others don't. See, this looks cool to me.
No, that looks pretty sweet. Fight when others won't. I just don't need that stress in my life from playing a video game, but it looks sweet.
Oh wow, it's first person? That I didn't know. I thought it was third. Sorry, are they like in a digital world? I can't.
No, the other people can't see. Well, who knows? Yo.
He just shot him with finger guns.
That's Bethesda.
Yeah, this looks dope. I'm gonna have to check that out. Ghostwire Tokyo. I heard about this game. Bethesda published Tango GameWorks. That makes sense, because Bethesda's published other Tango games.
What is this?
Sony wasn't playing, everybody.
They won't, bro.
just hit it after hit. They're like, we not wasting time. We know that we know y'all torn on what y'all gonna buy. We not gonna do it. We gonna give y'all what you can right now.
Bro, if they end with just gameplay and then don't say anything about the console, I'm gonna feel away though. Like,
oh, for sure.
Like, if, because Sony, here's the thing that I don't like about Sony, aside from everybody else. Sony will announce something that's not coming out until like 5 years later. Freaking yeah. Last Guardian came out on the whole another gen. Like,
yeah.
I need some dates or yeah, something.
That's what I need here.
Like, you can't sell me on something that's gonna come out at the end of the Sony's life, or, you know, the PS5's life, because I could just wait.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. I'm not interested in it, though. Don't like it for me. I don't do these games very much.
Trying to figure out what type of game it is.
Yeah.
Shoot, I'm down to try something new. Like, I found some really good games that if I was just looking at it, I probably would have never played it. But then after someone's, you know, telling me like, hey, they had a great time, you know, I jumped in and tried it and was like, oh, it's pretty great. The Far Shore. Yeah, that's one I need to see more of. Hey, at least they gave us something. Holiday.
Oh, we got a Gearbox.
Super Brothers. Ah, yeah, Super Brothers is great.
Okay, this looks sweet. Hey, they better stop playing and let me see some Avengers. That was probably last. Okay, and this trailer's on fire.
Oh, this is their three-man game coming out. Okay.
Yeah, this is your heart. Y'all gonna start putting some upcases on, I mean some lowercases on them G's when y'all putting your god like vibe start swinging on votes. Put some respect.
Oh no, this is the
Godfall.
I think it's this. Yeah, this is the one that's three players. I don't know what's up with the three player games. Excuse me.
It's Melee though, and I like Melee combat.
I think that's dope.
Like shooting games, and I really want more hand-to-hand games.
Or just different games in general, because...
Why haven't I got a martial arts battle royale yet? Why can't I throw hands with people?
Yeah, that would be great.
Right?
Holiday. Cool. I think Godfall is exclusive, though.
It looks like it. This looks cool.
Heart Machine presents. Wow, it looks like Hyper Light Drifter. Definitely same art style.
Whoa. Okay,
Shadow the Hedgehog. Okay. It looks cool visually. Like, I like the,
yeah.
The art style.
They keep. Ooh, okay. Color change. They teasing us. They're gonna drop the heat by the
solar ash.
They're gonna have to.
2021.
Look who it is. We know this ain't exclusive.
Oh, I haven't seen it yet.
I know, that's why I say that.
Oh, it's Hitman. Okay. You can't really go wrong with Hitman.
It's gonna end like this.
Mm-hmm.
All your hard work.
I see him outside, though.
All your sacrifice only sped up the process.
Give me a story. Stop just sending me out on hits.
Yeah.
Yourself alone.
Bro, these games coming out the first of next year. Like, all these games, like, these first quarter games, like, y'all gotta chill.
Only death awaits.
I mean, it depends on how they spread them out, because we haven't seen... And also, I hate that they're redoing the numbering on Hitman. It's like... All these games are still in the same canon. Oh,
this is the end of the trilogy.
Hakan Abrak here from IO Interactive.
IO.
Agent 47 is.
It can be confusing. But yeah, like.
Professional contract in his entire career.
I can understand them spreading things out.
This is also the dramatic.
If they're relying on third party as well.
Trilogy.
You don't want to dump all your exclusives early on and then have Agent nothing for however long.
On top of the world.
Yo, we get gameplay. Yo.
I wouldn't be surprised if this came to current gen as well.
Yeah, me too. Wait. This is cool. I bet that's how it turns on. They are low-key giving us stuff about the game while this is going on.
Oh, about the console, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because you can tell that's how it's booting up. They got their own mascot now. Sony said, we out here.
Like, literally out of the console.
Right. That's cool.
Astro's Playroom. That's dope.
Oh, what is this? This looks cool.
Man, they have a ton of games.
Yeah. This looks cool.
Neil Stream.
The next one, I think you're really gonna be interested.
Yeah, I like the way it looks.
Yeah. This exclusive is this is a game changer. This looks so dope. Yeah, if this plays well, this gonna win some awards because this artistically looks great.
Yeah, it's like they're made out of clay and paper.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm totally interested in this.
Yeah.
And this is the type of stuff I like, because it's artistic. It's not focused on how strong or how realistic the graphics can be. And because of that, it stands the test of time better. Because, like, things that we used to think that were, like, super, super dope graphically because they were realistic don't look realistic anymore. You know, like, the PS2 used to look real. You know what I mean? It does not anymore.
So funny in retrospect.
You know what I mean? Like, first seeing PS2 at E3 is like, yo, this is amazing graphics. And now it's like, meh.
Yeah, that game is getting purchased.
And what's dope about this game is, like, not even just the gameplay. I'm interested in, like, the world itself. Little Devil
NBA
Inside.
NBA 2K21 trailer. They really out here.
You know they got to come with their sports game, man. I'll be surprised if they don't show MLB.
Bro. I wasn't expecting to see 2K21 footage.
What's up, everyone?
For a while.
Zion Williamson of the New Orleans Pelicans. Here we go. The first ever teaser for NBA 2K21.
Zion doing it big out here. But the server's going to be trash, though. That's the real...
I don't know, but this visually looks crazy. I ain't trying to bring you down, but for real, you might as well give up now. Wait, he held on the rim? Got a chance, but I don't see how. Got a real tight grip when I hold that crown. I'm the first one in and the last one out. Whoever owns the place gotta drag me out.
Alpha footage, okay. Run for your life. Comes out this year.
That's a burger in a book.
Amazing, aren't they? Half bug, half snack. A very recently discovered species, entirely unique to this island. Oh,
wait,
this
what?
One's lively.
Beautiful. Oh, that's how you make yourself. So you eat the stuff that you find. So you literally are what you eat.
Welcome.
Astounding.
High from the craze of Octodad.
Yeah,
you know it's gonna be crazy. Definitely different.
Mm-hmm. Bug snacks.
Send you a talk to Jamie because he was like, you know, there's no more innovation. I'm like, bro.
Join me on the island of bug snacks.
Liz, hey, I was trying to carry a lamp.
Look at this.
But I dropped it, and now the town's on fire. Oh.
Okay.
Again.
Okay. Okay.
Bug snacks.
Okay. Yeah. Wait till the end of it, though. Okay, what you showing me right now?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, you see what they did?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Holiday 2020. That's coming everywhere, it looks like.
Oh, of course.
What we got? What we got? We got consoles. This console. Nope.
It's almost the end of the show.
Come on, Sony. I need a price.
PlayStation Studios.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for being with us today for this very special event. But before we get to the end of the show, I have something very near and dear to me.
What we got? What we got?
I don't know, but whoa, what is this? Oh, crap.
What is this? Is this a new Dark Souls?
That's what it looks like.
Nah, it's something different.
Demon Souls.
Wait, what?
Demon Souls, yeah.
I thought they stopped with the Demon Souls line. They made Dark Souls.
You just got a new Demon Souls game and it's exclusive to PlayStation.
That's crazy.
They got another one.
Demon's Souls, okay.
Uh-oh.
Deathloop is a next-gen first-person shooter.
Oh, Arcane.
Assassins locked in the time
loop. Yeah.
That's the Dishonored, folks.
What Arcane is all about. Freeform immersive gameplay. A surreal player-driven story smashed together.
Want to see some stylish action? Check this out.
This game I've been looking forward to hearing more about since they showed it off last.
This isn't exclusive, right?
Nah, this is from what I believe it's all systems. Except for the Switch, probably.
Not making Whoa. This easy.
Wait, is that a woman?
Yeah, it's I believe it's two. It's a woman and a guy protagonist.
Yo, this looks good. Restart loop. That looked like a brother, though.
Yeah, I think it's two. I think it's two black people.
Yeah, that's a brother.
Damn.
Yeah, I'm curious about the time stuff, how that factors in.
Black Reef. Another day, another death.
Wait.
Our time loops fun.
His outfit hard.
Everyone else on this island,
oh my god.
This place is paradise. A never ending party.
Where yeah, I'm playing this. Attraction.
And no matter how I try to escape, they always cut me down. But I'm one stubborn motherfucker.
Wow, the entire island is after you?
Wait.
Every loop I'm learning a little more. Piecing together the puzzle.
There is a black woman in it.
There's eight targets.
Yeah, they I told you. It's a black
but
man.
But wait, they're not on the same team, though.
Oh, word?
There's just one little snag.
You thought it was going to be easy?
Rival assassins.
Juliana Blake, Black Reef's protector. Pain in my ass. She may kill me a million times, but
first you don't succeed. Try and try again.
I will
die and die again.
This fucking loop.
Can I be her though?
I wonder if she's stuck in a time loop as well.
She is protecting them, so I wonder. It's like a, yo, and then they playing it like a old blaxploitation film. Wait, you can be her. I want that game.
Yeah, it looks dope. So I wonder, it's a different perspective.
Dog, but do you see, like, yo, I need that. And it's stylish. If it is two people and it's stuck in a time loop at the same time, essentially trying to, one trying to protect the group while the other person's trying to kill them, that seems cool.
That'd be an interesting multiplayer experience, yeah.
It would be.
Yeah, I was all over that game. I saw the protagonist and I heard the time loop stuff. I was
That trailer was like a blaxploitation film. That was so sweet.
Let's see, what's this?
They're gonna do a better job of energies because I'm all hyped up and you bring me to this downer.
This one seems lower, the volume wise. The rascal broke
free of Mother's voice and vanished into the trees.
Mother's worried cries faded fast as the girl ran on, over vine, under branch.
So I'm thinking this is first player, maybe survival horror.
What is it with that creepy story?
It's just a local tale.
You're really into that stuff?
Quit being so paranoid.
No, no! Friendly! Friendly! Who are you? Who sent you?
Y'all do it right. Y'all put a game out with bad before you put one I would. Smart.
Ha ha. What?
Yeah, bro.
Yep, I will be checking this out.
Resident Evil.
I thought so. I was about to say, this looks like Resident Evil.
Wait till you see the end of it.
Village.
Wait till you see the end of it.
Oh, see, this was rumored. This was rumored.
Yes. We are actually getting a new one. And the boy back. The OG is back.
Why?
Yep. Yep. I was just thinking, like, since Microsoft isn't doing anything right now, everybody's dumping their stuff into Sony's thing.
What is this?
Wait, didn't he say it's supposed to be end of the show? Like,
right, he said before we get to the end of the show.
Mm-hmm.
this. There's always a kid involved. Whoa.
I have no idea what I'm looking at right now.
Whoa, I don't either, but what is this coming out for? Whoa! Yo!
This is interesting.
What is that? The bar, man. It's sitting at the top of the Eiffel Tower at this point right now. Microsoft, I need you to come out with the bank. Our freedom.
This looks cool. I'm curious. Although, like, I remember Death Stranding looking like really cool, and then
it
turning out not to be such, you know, or FedEx. You know, a very acquired taste, you know.
FedEx Sim, yeah. Yeah, I am not that acquired taste, and I'll try mostly anything, but I couldn't.
Man, if they have a Game Pass like Microsoft, I mean, shoot.
Right.
All right, Sony Interactive. All right. This is definitely exclusive.
The old ones perished 1,000 years ago. Their great cities turned to graves.
Yes!
In their place came new life.
I knew you weren't gonna end this joint without this. I knew it. This is what I've been waiting for. This was my ish, dog. If you tell me it's coming out early this year, late this year, early next year, I'm buying a PlayStation without second thought. Come on.
And new dangers. Come on.
Oh.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
One of the best games to drop in the last, like, decade, dog.
I need to finish
that,
too.
He said there's no innovation. This was super innovative. The first one, so dope.
No depth I won't explore.
It should be a launch title. That would certainly help them out.
If it is, I'm buying. No, that's where I'm going first. I like you now. I really like the first one. I really, really, really like the first one.
Told you, Sonic.
Yo,
knocking out
look
of the
at
park.
These actors, dog.
Mission is mine alone. If I falter, if
yeah,
I fail,
they've been knocking it out the park with single player games.
Stop what's coming.
Forbidden West. Yo, this is it. This is so sweet. Watching this ain't no date.
I know, right? definitely. Just leave it up in the air.
Okay, we got somebody up here.
I like the robotic animals.
It's so sweet. It's so sweet. And the combat against them is everything.
Gorilla. So I guess they're not making a kill zone for all the people out there hyped on that.
This game's so better than those.
Facts. Although I wouldn't mind seeing a kill zone battle royale.
That would be cool. It's a world set for it.
Yeah.
Mysterious new threats. Get
ready to explore distant lands ravaged by massive storms.
And take on new, powerful machines as you return
to the majestic world of Horizon.
Stay tuned for much more. We can't wait for you to get your hands on it.
I need a date though, shawty.
Yeah, they played us.
I think there's a lot to look forward to for the community.
I think fans are going to be really pleased.
As a game designer and storyteller, this is incredibly exciting. We're talking a whole new generation of ideas and experiences that we
Bungie
can create for the player.
No matter where they are, no matter who they are.
New experiences like we've never had before.
More iconic, interesting characters, more atmospheric, immersive worlds for players to explore.
We want to wow players.
Expect the unexpected.
And I, for one, can't wait.
Can't wait.
We can't wait to share them with you.
It's so exciting.
This build-up is massive.
Really exciting. It's
really it is.
As a developer, that's an amazing feeling to have.
Welcome to PlayStation 5.
Come on. Come on. Come on.
Right, man. They already blew. Stop playing with me, man. Stop playing with me. Stop blowing on it. Give me the full thing.
All right, so we're gonna get the look.
Mm-hmm. Guys, this isn't as interesting as you think it is. Stop playing with us.
I know, right?
Hold on now. Oh, yo, okay, dog, they just showed it. I am tripping. Yo.
I'm still waiting.
When you get to it, wait till you see it, and I swear to God, it looks so familiar. It's just white. Wait till you see it.
Wow.
I swear to God, it jumped like a 360. Look at the build. Remember the 360 when it used to stand up? Remember how the shape was, the curvature in the middle? That's exactly what it looked like.
Yeah, they just put their spin on it. I swear, Sony and Microsoft just don't care about your setups. Like, we're going to make
why
the most awkward
console, my nigga? You know I'm sitting in this joint. Excuse me. Why would you do that to us? Because I have a whole, like most of our hard console, like our gaming setups are sideways. Why
yeah.
Why is it standing console? Only thing standing up is my computer.
Yeah, exactly.
Wait, what is this? Why are they showing them like PS5 digital? So they have a digital one. So if you don't want to buy this, not going to get me those.
No.
Give me my disc drive.
Yes. But what that does mean is there's two price points.
DualSense charging station. They show on the accessories.
I bet you Microsoft has that too with their series.
Mm-hmm. So you can give me a price or a date. I hate you, Sony. Stop playing with me. So that's what you did. Oh, I hate y'all. I hate y'all.
They're bringing back the media remote.
As if we need that. Like, our phones don't do most of those things for us now. Like, wirelessly, it does that without issue.
Like,
we hope you've enjoyed the first glimpse of our future.
At least on my Xbox, like I do so much of that just on my phone.
Yeah.
And you've seen games that can.
We're launching later this year.
The full range of PlayStation 5's features and power.
Can
I, at PlayStation, we believe in generational transition.
So they're not going to show us a date.
Gonna be crazy.
We want you to enjoy the unique benefits.
See, no date.
Moving from one generation.
No price.
Thank you for joining us. We're launching later this year.
I feel like they're just standing it up, but.
Welcome to PlayStation 5.
You think they're waiting until Microsoft announces their price so they could kind of undercut them?
Microsoft is like $4.99, $5.99. They're gonna be like, yeah. So ours is $5.85.
Yeah, because that's what it seemed to have done when they did it last time. They were like, yeah, Microsoft is this much. We're going to be $100 cheaper.
Oh, I get it. The V for the 5. Cool.
It also looks a little fragile, too, on the low.
Yeah, I'm a bit nervous about it.
I will be ready.
Haptic feedback. Oh, never had that before.
Okay. So what they showed was pretty great. A lot of third-party was tucked in there on the low. But all of it was, I liked all of what was shown.
Even the stuff that's not for me.
Diverse lineup. A lot of single-player games. And that's something I was saying before this started. Sony has been really strong with single-player games this last gen. And it looks like they're bringing it up this one as well,
because clearly the fans want that, man. Like,
exactly,
people everywhere are like, yo, like, we want, like, the PlayStation can play, you know, multiplayer games, but it's like, dog, sometimes I just want to play something by myself. And
exactly,
they're at least offering that.
Yep, they got platformers in there,
they got Miles in there.
Yep,
Miles,
another Spider-Man. Resident Evil was shown, which is, that's definitely something I want to play. NBA was shown, even though that's not exclusive,
you
it still was early. Cool.
You might as well show Madden.
Right, exactly. But it's and then the new Ratchet and Clank. I definitely want to check that out, and the game from Gearbox. But yeah, everything was really good. Like, there wasn't really a point where I was like, oh, this looks horrible, or oh, this looks like it's boring, or whatever the case. But I'm mad that there's no price or date.
Yeah.
The rumor was it was 600. That's what was shown on Amazon. So let me go ahead and pause this real quick.
I guess they nerves is like, do we tell them how much it is? You should tell me now so I can start putting my pennies together, bro.
Exactly. Like,
playing games with me.
I really think they're holding that close to their chest. Because they're like, if Microsoft goes lower, we might have to go lower too. And
you know,
crazy.
We didn't get any Avengers gameplay, man.
That might be locked in at Microsoft. You know how they do. Like, you know, we're going to show you a little bit later, a little bit closer to launch.
That's right, because it's not exclusive.
Right. So a lot of third party was, you know, because this, in a sense, if this was the E3 con, them showing Resident Evil was like a big, like, the crowd would go crazy, right? Even though it's not exclusive, it's a nice showing. So it's the same thing. Like, I'm pretty sure Microsoft has grabbed some third parties to be like, because you notice we didn't see Call of Duty.
Right.
So, like,
but we saw Infinity War. We did see the guy talking for me.
Right. So it might be something where we see that later. We see Call of Duty, the Avengers game. We didn't see Cyberpunk. You know what I mean? We might see that at Microsoft. So, you know, but yeah, I like what was shown today throughout IGN's thing, and especially with the Sony stuff. I like the look of the controller. I actually, the console's cool. I wish it wasn't upright. I'm pretty sure you could, you know, you'll be able to lie it down on its side.
Yeah,
but
it looks like it's supposed to lay down.
I hope, hopefully. And
somebody
said
it looks like a router.
It does. It does look like a router. We got the refrigerator and the router, or they're trying to, like, PCs on the low, like,
yeah,
you're you know what I'm saying, like, the boxiness of the PC and then the router right beside it. That's what you have. But yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I'm excited. Again, I still feel like, you know, this gen is, you know, it's still kicking, but I am excited for the new.
Done with it.
Of course you are.
I've moved on. I'm ready for another console.
One thing that I'm you know, kind of aware of is this whole with Corona going, you know, and whatnot, and things are being kind of out of whack. A lot of people out of work and stuff like that. I want to say that has to come into price. You know, that they have to think about that when pricing it. No, like, I mean, granted, if someone's not going to be able to afford a console, you know, because they lost their job, then I can kind of understand, like, they're not going to buy it anyways, right? But there are people who still are working, but they don't know how long this Corona thing is going to last, and so they're kind of holding their money close to their chest. So there are those people that you kind of have to think about as well. And then also, like we said, with Microsoft, if Microsoft goes lower, you know, because we don't have the Kinect this time around, if Microsoft goes lower, and the fact that you can use the old controllers with the new system, that might, you know, cut down pricing if you think about it. And I'm pretty sure Microsoft is going to have a digital-only version as well. So now it's like, do we show our price? And Microsoft kind of like, you know what? Let's just drop a zero. Let's just, you know, like, instead of like 500, let's bring it down to 4 since they went 5, you know. I can see that happening. So I kind of understand it. But at the very least, say November. Say October. Say September. Like, I think it's going to come November. I think they're both going to drop November. But right, at least let me know. Friday. Yeah, at least let me know. Like you said, to at least save up. At least, you know, get a ballpark. I mean, I'm not seeing anything lower than 300, 350. I'm curious to know what the digital version will be price-wise. But, yeah, man, I'm kind of bummed that they didn't show that part. Everything else looked great. But what were your some of your final thoughts?
Let's see. The design I don't dislike, but everything is super curvy now. Like, I'm not too sure. Like, what the future is apparently very curvy. We have the Spider-Man reveal was just like laid me out. I think I'm stoked conceptually. But I'm still torn because I don't know. I didn't get hardware specs too much. I got some cool games looking stuff, but like even then, like it's hard. I hate the way that they kind of define how you define what's exclusive to them and what's not. So we have to kind of go back, look at it again, and see what actually is solely on the on the PlayStation as opposed right. to on both. But the stuff that looks like it is for the console looks like stuff that is worth selling the console on. As of now, I mean, at least for me, I'm still riding the middle, but I'm gliding on the Sony side for right now. Until the real game breaker for real is going to be games once we get the Xbox reveal stuff, and price. If we get this joint, we found out that they both get some astronomical price, then I need to see who had the games on it first, because I'm not going to spend all that money for something that's just going to sit around. Right. So I need more detail there. I kind of like, this was cool because like game wise, like it got me excited because I want more games to play. But I think also like, I think we came in here kind of wanting more PS5 specific stuff. Right. And the games are cool, but we came here solely for console stuff. So we got shown things, but we didn't get explanations. Right. So like, this was a cool, like, it was like a highlight reel essentially. So it was like, we got all the highlights of it, but we didn't get like the meat and potatoes. So like, this is cool. Like, it was dope to enjoy and to get excited about new games. But the fact that they didn't mention a price makes me nervous. Like, I'm certain that we're going above $550 at this point. And it's just kind of crazy. Like, ideally, just justifying we about to be spending almost $1,000 on game consoles, which is just crazy.
Yeah, man. And that's the thing with, because it remind me of what we see at the press conferences, except for without the BS. You know, no one's coming out and talking about something for however long and not showing gameplay, right? Like, they kind of cut that down. So whatever they were going to show at E3 is basically what they showed here. The thing is, though, I think right now is the time to say the price, because it gives you the latter half of the year to get it. You know what I mean? Like, you don't want to say it and then a month later it drops. I'm sure there are going to be people who buy it, but I could use a little bit more time. You know what I mean? And like you said, like, we were coming to look for Sony stuff. Like, I was looking for stuff to show me, to make me change my mind on the Xbox Series S. That's what I was looking for. Yeah. And right now, you know, from the spec-wise, they're really neck and neck. They're both promoting the fact that you can, you don't have to worry about load times and stuff like that. Awesome. What's pushing me towards Microsoft right now is solely the idea that I get the games that I'm going to buy for my Xbox One coming up, like Cyberpunk. I'm going to automatically get it on the Xbox One X, Xbox Series X, or Series S or whatever. And that's a big selling point because I'm still buying games for my console. On top of that, being able to use my old controllers and stuff like that, all of my peripherals, the headset that I got, that's dope too. And so it comes down to what are the exclusives that we're going to get on both sides. Right now, Sony looks great. The Ratchet
Wait,
and Clank.
Wait, is this game solely about Miles? I'm sorry, I'm going to cut you off. I'm still watching the stuff and they're showing more.
Like, yeah, it looks like it's just Miles. That's what it looks like. And it's named Miles. It has his name in it. Spider-Man Miles Morales. So like, yeah, like I like for instance, Spider-Man is only going to be on Sony. Ratchet and Clank is only going to be on Sony. You know, a bunch of the stuff that they've shown that's only Sony looked great. Not going to lie. And I want to play them all. So there's that. Microsoft has
no Xbox, man. Like, that's just like, that's such a deal breaker for me, dog. Like, I was not this adamant about this character until you just told me it was a whole game. Like, I'm done. Like,
yeah,
just done.
I'm still in the middle.
Microsoft, when they come back, I'm done.
Like, I'm still done. In the middle. Because honestly, for like I said before, I'm gonna get both. It's just when I get one, you know, launch day versus maybe a year from afterwards, is gonna depend on a lot of factors. And there's stuff that some key things from Sony that I'm still missing, and same thing with Microsoft. Hopefully, when Microsoft shows their stuff, we'll get some exclusives that are actually gonna come out and not be canceled. I'm looking at, you know, what they did with Platinum Games. I totally want to see some new stuff, and all the studios that you guys bought, you need to, you gotta ramp it up. You know what I mean? Like, I need to see some cool stuff. And then price, like, you're competing for my dollars in that sense.
And they still ain't telling us about our dollars yet. Like.
And same thing with release date, because if you tell me the price too late, I mean, granted, you want to start saving up now, but, you know, stuff happens, right? You know, I want to be able to pre-order, I want to be able to blah, 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 and so, yeah. All in all, though, I will say day two was good. There was a lot of good games. I liked how IGN is still doing the charity work that they're doing with COVID-19 and the Bell Project. Definitely donate if you can. I like how they pushed up the indie games first before we saw all the big stuff, because they typically don't get the same light. I like that we get to see a ton of PlayStation stuff. And yeah, I'm looking forward to day three. And more, you know, stuff. Hopefully Microsoft announced something soon. I think they're going to do the, was it the Microsoft event, the Xbox event, fan event, or something like that, where they might show us some stuff there. But yeah, all in all, good day for gaming. So yeah, feel free to hit the subscribe button and the notification bell so you can see all of the content that we have going up. There's a ton of it. Also, check out our day one recap with me and Jamie, aka UFG Blaze. We talked about all the stuff there. Oh, I don't know if you saw day one, Dre, but they showed Yakuza Like a Dragon. I'm getting the game.
Yep.
I'm getting it.
I knew that. I told you that. That's been my. I told you since the jump when I found out it was going to be a JRPG, I was going to get it.
Yeah, it looks great, and I love what they're doing with it. So yeah, day one is in the bag. Go check that out. It's also on the website, unitedfrontgaming.com. And we have a ton of stuff, like I said, that's going up on the YouTube page outside of our recaps. That includes the UFG plays. We played Mario Maker 2 recently, me and Ricardo. We also have our Saturday night streams where we played Valorant, had a good time. So yeah, like I said, check all that stuff out. And follow us. You can follow me on Twitter and on Instagram now at KennyUFG. You can follow the website at u_f_g, and you can follow Andre on Twitter at smeblacknerd. And that's it. Thanks for spending, you know, some time with us, and we will see you next time.
We out.